Act I of Electra by Benito Perez Galdós, translated by Charles Arthur Tyrrell. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Electra, a drama in five acts by Benito Perez Galdós, played for the first time in the Teatro Español of Madrid, January 30, 1901. Persons.
Electra, read by Amanda Friday.
Evarista, read by Sarah Terry.
Maximo, read by Kay Hand.
Don Salvador Pantoja, read by Negatron.
The Marquis of Ronda, read by Todd.
Don Urbano Garcia Yuste, read by Phil Schempf.
Mariano, read by Eden Ray Hedrick.
Gil, a mathematician, read by Abai.
Balbina, read by Ethelbus.
Patros, a young servant, read by C.J. Plog.
Jose, an old manservant, read by Om123.
Sister Dorothea, read by Beth Thomas.
A workman, read by David Olson.
The Shade of Eleutheria, read by Mary Kay.
Stage directions, read by Rapunzelina. The action takes place in Madrid, in the present. Electra, Act I. Hall luxuriously furnished in the mansion of the Garcia Yustes. At the right, a passageway to the garden. At the back, communication with the other rooms of the building. At the right, in front, entrance to the room of Electra. Scene 1. Marquis. José at the back. José?
They are in the garden. I'll take them word.
Marquis?
Wait. I want to look around the room. I haven't visited the Garcia Yos since they have been in their new house. What luxury! They are doing well. God gives them enough for everything, and this is nothing in comparison with what they give to charity. Always so generous.
Yes, indeed, sir.
And always so unassuming. But there is in the family, I believe, an interesting novelty.
Novelty? Oh, yes, you mean.
Listen, Jose, will you do what I ask you?
The Marquis knows that I shall never forget the 14 years that I was in his service. Command, Your Excellency.
Well, then. Today I have come solely for the purpose of making the acquaintance of this young lady that your master and mistress brought recently from a school in France.
Miss Electra?
Can you tell me whether her uncle and aunt are pleased with her? Whether the girl shows herself affectionate, grateful?
Oh, yes, they love her, but...
What?
The girl is a little mischievous.
At her age...
Playful. Very playful, sir.
She is very pretty. As they say, an angel?
An angel, yes. If there are angels very similar to demons. She drives us all crazy.
How I want to know her!
Your Excellency may find her in the garden. She passes the whole morning there, throwing things about and playing pranks.
Marquis, looking into the garden.
Pretty garden, more like a park. The old forest of the ancient palace of Jaravalinas.
Yes, sir.
That magnificent house next door. Doesn't that belong to your master, too?
With an entrance from the garden, and also from the street. On the ground floor, the nephew of my master and mistress, Mr. Maximo, has his laboratory. He is the first mathematician of Spain, and in...
Yes, he whom they call the wonderful magician. I knew him in London. I don't remember just when. Is his wife living yet?
The poor fellow was left a widower in February of last year. He has two beautiful children.
Not long ago I renewed my acquaintance with Maximo, and though I do not frequent his house, for reasons of my own, we are great friends, the best friends in the world.
I am very fond of him, too. He is so good.
And tell me now, aren't your master and mistress sorry they brought this little demon here?
Jose, fearing that someone is coming.
I shall tell, Your Excellency. I have noticed.
Sees Don Urbano coming from the garden.
My master is coming.
You may go.
Scene 2. Marquis, Don Urbano. Marquis, embracing him.
My dear Urbano.
Don Urbano.
Marquis, how glad I am to see you.
And Evarista?
Well, and wondering at the absence of the illustrious Marquis of Ronga.
Oh, you don't know what a winter we have passed.
And Virginia?
She is not well. The poor girl, always struggling with her attacks. She lives by main strength. Stubbornness, I say, of her strong will.
Well, well. So?
Pointing to the garden.
Shall we go down?
Pretty soon. Let me rest a moment.
Sits down.
Tell me, dear Urbano, about this charming girl, this Electra, whom you have just brought from school.
She wasn't still in school. She was living in Hendaye with some relatives of her mother. I never was in favor of bringing her to live with us, but Evarista took the idea into her head some time ago. Her only object is to test the character of the child, to see if we can make out of her a good woman, or if God reserves for us the shame that she should inherit the evil habits of her mother. You know, she was the first cousin of my wife, and I need not repeat to you the excesses of Eleuteria between the years 80 and 85.
Of course not. Of course not.
They were such that the family, grieved and mortified, broke off all relations with her. This child, whose father is not known, grew up with her mother until she was 5 years old. Then they took her to the convent of the Ursulinas at Bayonne. There, either for short or to embellish the name, they insisted on calling her Electra, which is quite a novelty.
Pardon me, not really a novelty. For her intimates called the unhappy mother, Eleuteria Diaz, Electra, not only for short, but also because they gave the name of Agamemnon to her father, who was a very valiant soldier, very unhappy in his married life.
I didn't know. I never had anything to do with those people. Eleuteria, on account of her reputation for wildness, was pictured to me as a very repugnant person.
Good heavens, my dear Urbano, don't be too severe. Remember that Eleuteria, whom we shall call Electra I, changed her life. It must have been about the year 88.
About that time. Her repentance made considerable talk. She died in San Jose de la Penitencia in 1895, reformed and hating her past.
Marquis, as if blaming him for his severity.
God pardoned her.
Yes, yes. Pardon, I forget.
And you, now, are testing Electra II to see if she will turn out crooked or straight? And what has been the result of your tests?
Results rather doubtful, contradictory, varying each day, every hour. There are moments in which the child shows admirable qualities, badly concealed beneath her innocence, moments in which she seems the most crazy creature that God ever put into the world. At the very same time, she charms you with her angelical candor. She frightens you with her diabolical smartness, which she gets from her own innocence.
An excess of imagination, perhaps? Lack of balance? Is she lively?
As lively as electricity itself. Mysterious. So abrupt that she frightens you. She tears up things, turns them upside down, but brightens them up.
Marquis, rising.
I am burning with curiosity. Let us go and see her.
Scene 3. Marquis, Don Urbano, Cuesta at the back. Cuesta enters with appearance of fatigue, takes out his portfolio of papers and turns to the table.
Marquis, and how are you all here?
Hello, old Cuesta. What has our untiring agent to tell us?
Cuesta, sitting down, seems to have an affection of the heart.
The untiring one, alas, is tired now.
Well, what can you tell us of the rise yesterday in the amalgamated stock?
It came from Paris at 2 points.
Did you make our settlement?
And mine?
I am coming to that.
Takes out some papers from his portfolio and writes.
You shall have the exact figures right away. I got the very best possible from the exchange.
Of course. The par value of the new shares being 79.50. We having picked up the paper at a very low price.
Of course.
Of course the result has been splendid.
The ease with which we become rich, my dear Urbano, kindles in us the love of life and the enthusiasm for human beauty. Let's go into the garden.
Don Urbano to Cuesta.
Are you coming?
I shall need 10 minutes to arrange my notes.
Then we'll leave you alone. Do you wish anything?
Cuesta, buried in his notes.
No. Yes, a glass of water. I'm burning up.
In a minute.
Goes out with the Marquis into the garden. Scene 4. Cuesta, Patros. Cuesta, correcting his notes.
Ah, yes, there was an error. To the Eustis there are due 1,700,000 pesetas. To the Marquis of Ronda, 222,000. We must discount the 12,000 odd, equal to 9,000 francs.
Enter Patros with glasses of water, sugar, cognac. She waits a moment until Cuesta finishes his calculation.
Shall I leave it here, Don Leonardo?
Put it down and wait a minute. 1,800,000, with the 710, make. It's plain now. Good, good. All right, Petros.
Puts his hand in his pocket, takes out some money, and gives it to her.
Thank you, sir.
That's the way I tell you that I expect a favor from you.
Command me, Don Leonardo.
Well?
Fingering the sugar cone.
You see?
Aren't you going to put in any cognac? If you've come in warm, the water alone may hurt you.
Yes, a little. But I wish... Don't misunderstand me. I should like to speak a moment alone with Miss Electra. Knowing me as you do, you will understand that my object is the best and most honorable. I say this to remove any scruples you may have.
Gathers up his papers.
Before anyone comes, tell me what time and place would be the most appropriate.
To say a few words to Miss Electra.
Thinking.
It would probably be when my master and mistress are busy with the lawyer. I shall be on the lookout.
If it could be today, so much the better.
Will you be back soon?
I shall be back, and you can let me know quietly.
Yes, yes. You may be sure I will.
Gathers up the service and retires. Scene 5. Cuesta, Pantoja, dressed entirely in black, enters meditating and absorbed in thought.
Friend, Pantoja, may God be with you. Are you well?
Pantoja sighs.
Oh, still living, my friend, that is to say, hoping.
Hoping for a better life.
Suffering in this one all the Lord wills in order to be worthy of the other.
And your health?
So-so. Bad because troubles and disease afflict me. Good because pain gratifies me and suffering makes me rejoice.
Uneasy and as if dominated by a fixed idea, looking towards the garden.
You are an aesthetic.
Oh, that crazy girl. See her running with the porter's boys, with the children of Maximo and the others of the neighborhood. When they let her break loose in childish pranks, this Electra is in her glory.
Beautiful doll. May it please God to make of her a woman of merit.
An angel could come out of the graceful doll, of the fickle girl, more easily than it could of the woman.
I don't understand you, friend Pantoja.
I do. Look! Look how they are playing!
Alarmed.
Heaven help me! Whom do I see there? Is that the Marquis of Ronda?
His very self.
that corrupt corrupter, the Don Juan of the past generation. He has decided not to retire in order not to disappoint Satan.
In order that it may be said, once more, that there is no paradise without its serpent.
No, no. A serpent we had already.
Nervous and fretful, he walks up and down the stage.
Another thing. Haven't you heard about the million? I am bringing them.
Pantoja, without paying much attention to the matter, fixed on another idea which is not manifest.
Yes, I know. Yes. We gained a lot.
And you will give larger sums to San Jose de la Penitencia.
Yes.
Repeating a fixed idea.
We had a serpent already.
Aloud.
What were you saying to me, friend Cuesta?
That.
I beg your pardon. Is it a fact that our neighbor next door, our wonderful sage, inventor, and almost miracle worker, is thinking of changing his residence?
Who? Maximo? I think so. It seems that in Bilbao and in Barcelona, they welcome with enthusiasm his wonderful studies of new applications of electricity. And they offer him all the capital he needs to develop these discoveries.
Pantoja meditating.
Oh, capital. Within my means, I would give it to him, provided he...
Scene 6. Pantoja, Cuesta, Evarista, Don Urbano, the Marquis, who come in from the garden. Evarista releasing the arm of the Marquis.
Ah, congratulations, Cuesta. Pantoja, how glad I am to see you today.
Cuesta and Pantoja bow and kiss her hand respectfully. She sits down at the right, the Marquis standing at her side. The other three form a group at the left, talking business. Marquis resuming with Evarista an interrupted conversation.
In this way you will pass not only into history, but into the lives of the saints.
Marquis, don't praise that which is absolutely lacking in merit. We have no children. God gave us greater and greater wealth. Each year a new inheritance came to us, without troubling ourselves in the least, nor scheming in any way. The margin of our income, managed in clever operations by our friend Cuesta, has brought us more wealth without our knowing it. We bought a country place, and that very year the rise in produce tripled its value. We acquired a piece of barren land and found that it is an immense storehouse of coal, of iron, of lead. What does that mean, Marquis?
It means, my dear friend, that when God heaps so many riches on one who does not desire them nor esteem them, it means very clearly that he does so that they may be used to his service.
Exactly. And interpreting it in the same way, I hasten to fulfill the divine will. That which Cuesta brings me today will merely pass through my hands, and with this I shall have given to the patrocinio 7 whole millions, and I shall do even more, in order that the establishment and school in Madrid may have all the decorations and magnificence that is fitting to so great an institution. We shall stimulate the work of the schools in Valencia and Cadiz.
Pantoja, passing the group on the right.
Without forgetting, my friend, the institution for higher instruction, which is to be a sanctuary of true science.
My friend Pantoja knows very well that I never cease thinking of it.
Don Urbano, passing also to the right.
We are thinking of it night and day.
Fine, fine.
Rises. Evarista to Cuesta, who also passes to the right.
Ah, oh, and now, Leonardo, what are we going to do?
Cuesta, sitting down by the side of Evarista, proposes to her new transactions.
We shall limit ourselves to carrying over some sums.
Pantoja, standing at the left of Evarista.
Or with premiums.
Marquis, passing across the stage with Don Urbano.
Allow me to ask, my dear Urbano, that proclaiming the merits of your wife, you do not forget mine, ours. I speak for my wife and myself. Virginia has already given to Las Enclavas the half of our fortune.
One of the most important in Andalusia.
And in our wills we leave them all, except a portion which we have destined to fulfill certain obligations and for poor relations.
Very good. But as I understood a few years ago, you were not so well satisfied with Virginia's generous piety.
That's true. But in the end, I learned the catechism. I am in it body and soul. She has converted me, has regenerated me.
As my Evarista has done me.
To preserve peace in the family, I began by temporizing, by yielding. And yielding and temporizing, I have come to this point. It doesn't worry me, no. Today I live in a beatific peace, cured of my old manias. I have come to believe that Virginia will not only save her own soul, but mine, too.
The same with me, that she will save me.
It is certain that we have the initiative in nothing.
In nothing, my dear Marquis.
Why, sometimes even breathing is forbidden us.
Even breathing forbidden?
But we live in tranquility.
We serve God without any effort.
Our blessed wives precede us along the road to a blessed eternity. Have no fear that they will leave us behind.
Of course not.
Urbano!
Don Urbano, hastening to her.
What?
Put yourself at the disposal of Cuesta for the settlement and to give over to the fathers.
This very day.
Cuesta rises.
Another thing. Go down a moment and tell Electra that she has played 3 hours now.
Pantoja, in a commanding tone.
Tell her to come up. She has frisked about too much already.
I am going.
Seeing Electra coming.
Here she is now.
Scene 7. The same. Electra. After her, Maximo. Electra enters running and laughing, followed by Maximo, whom she is outdistancing. Her laughter is that of childish fear.
Don't you catch me? Brute, I'll show you.
Maximo carries in one hand various objects which will be indicated, in the other a large branch of poplar which he handles like a whip.
Rogue, if I catch you.
Electra, without noticing the others on the stage, runs around with childlike agility and takes refuge in the skirts of Doña Evarista, kneeling at her feet and throwing her arms around her waist.
I am safe. Aunt, tell him to go away.
Where is the crazy girl?
With jesting threats.
Ah, she knows where to go.
Why, girl, when will you learn gravity? Maximo, you are as much a child as she.
Maximo, showing what he is carrying.
Look what she has done for me. She broke these 2 test tubes. And then, see these papers on which I had calculations that represent enormous work.
Shows the papers. Holding them up.
This one she made a bird of. That one she gave to the children to paint donkeys and elephants on. And an ironclad firing at a castle.
Why did she go into the laboratory?
And she spoiled my discipline of the children and turned everything upside down.
Pantoja with severity.
But my dear young lady.
Electra.
Blessed childhood.
With enthusiasm.
Electra, you big child. Blessed be your pranks. Keep as long as you can your precious gaiety.
I didn't break the cylinders. It was Pepito. The papers full of scratches. I did take them, thinking they were of no use.
Come, let's make peace.
Peace.
To Electra.
All right, I'll spare your life. I'll excuse you this time. Here.
Gives her the switch. Electra takes it. Whipping him severely.
This for what you have said to me.
Whipping him with force.
This for what you didn't say.
Why, what didn't I say?
Gravity. Reason.
What have I told you?
Truths that will be very useful to her. That she should learn for herself many things that she doesn't know. That she should open wide her eyes and cast them over human life to see that all is not gaiety. That there are also duties, sorrows, sacrifices.
Heavens, how it frightens me!
All surround her in the center of the stage, except Pantoja, who hastens to the side of Evarista.
It is best not to stimulate her pranks by applause.
And to show her a little of severity.
No one can outdo me in severity. Isn't it true, girl, that I am very severe, and that you thank me for it? Say that you thank me for it.
Electra, whipping him lightly.
Wise accuser! If this were a real whip, I should whip you with greater pleasure.
Maximo, smiling and amused.
Charming one! Whip me, Electra.
Electra, whipping him with gentleness.
You? No, for I haven't confidence. A little, no more. So.
Whipping the others.
And you. And you. A little.
Why don't you go and play the piano for these gentlemen?
Why, she doesn't study a note. Her indolence is as great as her aptitude for all the arts.
Let her show us her watercolors and drawings. Come and see, Marquis.
They all group themselves around the table, except Evarista and Pantoja, who talk aside.
Why, yes!
Looking for her sketchbook among the books and papers that are on the table.
You will see, I am a great artist.
Praise yourself, chatterbox.
Electra, untying the ribbon of her sketchbook.
You run me down, I'll brag. We'll see who comes out the better. Oh!
Showing some drawings.
You are astonished. What do you say to these magnificent sketches of landscapes, of animals that look like people, of people that look like animals?
All are amazed, looking at the drawings which pass from hand to hand. Evarista, leaving the central group, begins a conversation with Pantoja.
You are right, Salvador. You always are, and now in the case of Electra, your reasoning is like a splendid orb of light which puts us all in the shade.
This light which you think intelligence is not. It is only the brightness of an intense fire that burns within. Will. By this force, which I owe to God, I have been able to mend my error.
After the confidences which you made to me last night, I see more clearly your right to intervene in the education of this crazy head.
To indicate the way for her, to point out her high ends.
A right which implies inexcusable duties.
Oh, how glad I am that you recognize it, my dear friend. I feared that my confidence of last night, a dark story which blackens the best years of my life, would make me lose your esteem.
No, my friend, no. As a man, you have been subject to human weaknesses. But the sinner has been regenerated, punishing himself with the mortification that repentance brings, and strengthening it in the practice of virtue.
Sadness, love of solitude, contempt for vanities were my salvation. Well, my reparation would not be complete if I did not take care to direct this girl, to keep her from harm. If we lack care, it would be easy for her to go the way of her mother.
My opinion is that you should talk to her.
Alone.
That's what I think. Alone. Give her to understand in a delicate way the authority you have over her.
Yes. Yes, that is my wish.
Continues in a low voice. Electra, in the central group, quarreling with Maximo.
Stop! Stop! What do you know?
Showing a drawing.
This brute says that the bird looks like a pensive old man, and the woman like a pale lobster.
Oh, no! This is very good!
Sometimes, when she takes the least care, she gets wonderful results.
The truth is that this landscape, with the distant sea and these trunks...
My specialty. Don't you know what it is? Well, old trunks, walls, and ruins. I paint well what I don't know. Sadness, the past, death, present gaiety, youth. I can't do them.
With sorrow.
I am a great artist, for all that I have not experienced.
What grace!
How bright! It charms me to hear her.
Soon reflection will come, responsibilities.
Electra making fun of Maximo.
Reason, seriousness. Look at the sage. Gloomy. I shall have all this whenever I like, and more than you.
We shall see, we shall see.
Pantoja, who has been listening to the group.
I can't hide from you that I do not like the familiarity of the girl with the nephew of Urbano.
We shall correct that. But bear in mind that Maximo is an honorable man, sensible.
Yes, yes, but, my friend, In the paths of confidence, the strongest stumble and fall. A sad experience has taught me that.
Electra in the central group.
I shall settle down when it suits me. Nobody should become serious until God commands. No one should say, alas, alas, until sorrow comes.
That's so.
And then one learns practical things.
Of course, when God comes and says to me, child, here is sorrow, suffering, doubt.
He will say it, and soon.
Electra, my daughter, don't be silly.
Aunt, it is Maximo who...
goes to her aunt's side.
Maximo is right.
Certainly.
Questa and Don Urbano also go to the side of Evarista, leaving Maximo and the Marquis alone at the left.
May I know, Marquis, the result of your first observations?
The girl has charmed me. I see there is no exaggeration in what you told me.
And doesn't your penetration discover underneath these jests something that...
I understand. Moral beauty. Common sense. I haven't had time yet for such discoveries. I shall continue my observations.
Because I, to tell the truth, consecrated to science at an early age, know very little of the world, and human characters are for me a writing that I can scarcely decipher.
Well, in this writing, and in others, I know how to read fluently.
Will you come to my house?
For a while. It is possible that my wife may scold me if she knows that I have visited the laboratory of electricity and the manufactory of light. But Virginia will not be very severe. I may venture. Afterwards I shall return here under pretext of seeing the girl at the piano. I shall talk to her and continue my studies.
Maximo, aloud.
Are you coming, Marquis?
You are leaving us.
I'm going with my friend for a while.
Marquis, I am much vexed at your long absence, much vexed. You cannot make amends better than by lunching with us today. It is a punishment, Don Juan. It is penitence.
I accept as atonement for my guilt, and I bless the hand that punishes me.
You, Maximo, will you come too?
If they leave me free at that hour, I shall come.
Don't come. For heaven's sake, don't come.
With a joy that she cannot hide.
You are going to come? Say yes.
Correcting herself.
No, no, say no.
Oh, you can't get rid of me. Crazy girl, you will come to your senses, perhaps.
And you will lose yours, foolish sage, old...
Electra follows him with her glances until he leaves. Maximo and the Marquis go out through the garden. José enters at the back. Scene 8. Electra, Evarista, Don Urbano, Pantoja, Cuesta, José. José announcing.
The Mother Superior of San José de la Penitencia.
Oh, my good sister, Barbara de la Cruz.
Let her come in here.
Getting up?
No, in the salon. Come.
What a fortunate opportunity. So I shall not have to go to the convent.
Girl, go to your studies.
Indicating the next room. Cuesta taking leave.
I am going. I shall come back presently.
Goodbye.
Cuesta aside to Electra.
Will they leave you alone?
Pantoja hastening to Electra.
Cultivate with care, Electra, this sublime art. Consecrate all your talent to the great Bach, in order that you may assimilate the religious style.
All leave except Electra. Scene 9. Electra, presently Cuesta. Electra, humming a church psalm, gathers up her drawings and arranges them.
Bach, in order that I may assimilate. How fine, the religious style.
Sings. Cuesta enters at the back, concealing himself.
Alone.
Electra sings some liturgical notes, sees Cuesta.
Why didn't you go, Don Leonardo?
Cuesta, timidly.
Yes, but I came back. My daughter, I want to talk with you.
Electra, a little frightened.
With me?
The matter is a delicate one, very delicate.
With fatigue, breathing with difficulty.
Pardon me. I suffer from my heart. I cannot stand.
Electra hands him a chair. He sits down.
Yes, the matter is such a delicate one that I do not know where to begin.
Goodness, what is it?
Questa, becoming animated.
Electra, I knew your mother.
Ah, my mother was very unhappy.
What do you mean by unhappy?
Why, she lived among bad people who would not let her be as good as she wished.
Oh, without knowing it, you have told a great truth. Do you remember your mother? Do you think of her?
My mother is for me a vague memory, but a sweet one, an image that never leaves me. I keep her alive in my heart, for she is still only a great memory, and in this memory my eyes are always seeking anxiously to see her. My poor mother.
Raises her handkerchief to her eyes. Questa sighs.
Tell me, Don Leonardo, when did you know my mother? Was she still very young?
You were a tiny little thing. We used to tickle you to make you laugh. Your laughter seemed an enchantment to me. The joy of nature.
You see why I have turned out so foolish. So mischievous, so thoughtless. And sometimes you used to take me in your arms?
Many times.
Electra, smiling without having dried her tears.
And didn't I pull your mustache sometimes?
Sometimes so hard that you hurt me.
You would slap me on my hands.
Come, come.
Why, don't you know? I believe they still hurt.
Questa, impatient to come to his subject.
But let's come to the subject. I warn you, Electra, that this is strictly confidential. It must be between us two.
Oh, you frighten me, Don Leonardo.
There is no cause for fear. You see in me a friend, the best of friends. You will see in this act the purest interest, the highest sentiments.
Electra, confused.
Yes, yes, I don't doubt it, but...
You will see why I take this step. Although I am not very old, I do not feel that I have the vitality for very long. A widower for 20 years. I have no other family than my daughter, Parker, married and gone away. I am almost alone in the world, with my foot in the stirrup to pass over to the other. And my solitude, alas, seems if it would carry me there more quickly.
With great difficulty in expressing himself.
But before I go...
Pause.
Electra, I thought about you a great deal, before they brought you to Madrid. And on seeing you, my God, I have thought, I have felt, how shall I say it, a sweet affection, the purest of affections, mingled with the clamours of my conscience.
Electra, astounded.
Conscience? What a grave thing that must be. Mine is like a babe that is still in the cradle.
Questa, with sadness.
Mine is old and full of memories. I repeat, it points out to me, without ceasing, the grave errors of my life.
You! Grave errors! And you so good!
Yes, yes, good, good, and a sinner. In short, let us leave the errors, and let us come to their consequences. I do not wish that you should live unprotected. You do not possess any fortune. It is doubtful whether the protection of Urbano and Evarista will be constant. How can I consent that you should be left poor and destitute some day when least expected?
Electra, with a painful struggle between her consciousness and her innocence.
I don't know whether I understand. I don't know whether I ought to understand.
The most delicate thing would be to understand without telling me so, and accept my protection without thanking me. My duty and your rights go hand in hand. Thanks to me, Electra, there will not be broken the thread that unites each creature with those that have been and with those that still exist. And if I have made up my mind to broach this question today, it is because a short time ago there came over me the fear of sudden death. My father and my brother died as if struck by lightning, the lesion of the heart, destroyer of my family. I have it too.
Pointing to his heart.
It is a doleful clock that counts for me the days, the hours. I cannot put this off. Death must not surprise me, leaving this precious one without protection. I cannot wait. I must end by telling you, my daughter, that you may be assured of a modest fortune.
A modest fortune? I?
Sufficient to live in a fitting independence.
Electra, confused.
And I? What merit have I for... Pardon me, I cannot convince myself of...
It will come. The conviction will come.
And why do you not speak of this matter to my uncle and aunt?
Questa, preoccupied.
Because I will tell them in time. Just now, only you must know my intention.
But...
Questa, with emotion rising.
And now, Electra, will you love this poor invalid, whose days are numbered?
Yes, it is easy for me to love. But don't talk of dying, Don Leonardo.
It comforts me to know that you will weep.
Don't make me begin now.
Questa, hastening his departure to conquer his emotions.
Goodbye, my daughter.
Goodbye.
Detaining him.
And what name shall I give you?
That of a friend. No more. Goodbye.
Releasing himself to leave, goes out at the back. Electra gazes after him until he disappears. Scene 10. Electra, the Marquis. Electra meditating.
Goodness, what am I to think? His broken sentences say more than if they were completed. My darling mother.
The Marquis, who enters from the garden, advances slowly.
Ah, Marquis!
Did I frighten you?
Not at all. Just surprised me. If you have come to hear me play, the journey is in vain. I shall not study today.
I am glad. Then we shall be able to talk. Scarcely have I met you, and I am filled with admiration of your charms. And knowing something of your character, I am anxious to know more. You wonder perhaps at this curiosity of mine, and may think it somewhat impertinent.
Oh, no, sir. I too am curious. And allow me to ask, are you a friend of Maximo?
I love him and admire him very much. Strange thing, isn't it?
To me it seems quite natural.
You are but a girl, and perhaps you cannot understand the reasons for my friendship with the wonderful magician. Let's see if you understand me.
Explain it to me clearly.
The society that I frequent, the circle of my own family, and the habits of my house, produce in me an asphyxiating effect. Almost without knowing it, through mere instinct for self-preservation, I throw myself at times into an atmosphere that I can breathe. My eyes turn to science, to nature. And Maximo is all this.
Air, you can breathe. Life. Why, you know, Marquis, it seems to me that I understand.
Well, child, you are not stupid at all. You must know, too, that I feel for this fellow an immense interest.
You love him and admire him for his great qualities.
And I am sorry for him on account of his misfortunes.
Electra, surprised.
Maximo unfortunate.
What greater misfortune than the solitude in which he lives? His premature widowerhood has submerged him in the deepest studies, and I fear for his health.
His children console him and keep him company. You have seen them today. What pretty dears! The older, who is 5 years old now, is a marvel of intelligence. In the little one, who is 2, I see all the graces in the world. I adore them, I dream of them, and I should like very much to be their nurse.
Poor Maximo, wrapped in his studies, cannot attend to them as he ought.
Of course not. That's what I say.
It is very evident. Maximo needs a wife. But here is where my troubles begin and my doubts. No matter where I look, I cannot find a woman who is worthy to share in the life of the great man.
You will not find her. There is none. There is none. Because for Maximo you must seek a woman of great sense.
That's it. Of great sense.
Just the opposite from me, for I have none. None, none.
I shouldn't say that.
Another thing. When you hear me say silly things to him, and call him brute, old man, foolish sage, you mustn't think that I say them seriously. It's all in fun, Marquis.
Of course, of course. I understood that.
Fun, impertinent, perhaps, for Maximo is very serious. Do you think, sir, that I ought to become very sober?
Oh, no. All creatures are as God made them. One must not restrain oneself. It is not necessary to be sober to be good.
Well, you see, Marquis, I, who don't know anything, I have thought the same way.
Pantoja appears in the background. Pantoja aside in the doorway.
That incorrigible libertine, that veteran of vice, dares to cast his poisonous glance upon this flower.
Advances slowly. Marquis aside.
Well, the dark shade has come between us, and we cannot talk any more.
The Marquis came to hear me play, but I am very dull. We shall leave it for another day.
You know that the great Beethoven is my passion. They have told me that Elektra interprets him splendidly, and I was hoping to hear his Sonata Pathétique and the Moonlight Sonata. But we have amused ourselves chattering, and since there is no opportunity...
Pantoja with asperity.
Yes, the study hour is over now.
Marquis, recovering his society manner.
Another day, perhaps. My friend, Virginia and I shall be much pleased if you will honor us with your counsel with reference to the convent of Las Esclavas.
Yes, yes. I shall go this afternoon to see Virginia, and we can talk it over.
You will find her at the convent all the afternoon. And since I am the troupe here...
With a gesture of leaving.
No, not at all, Marquis.
I must go, with the music, to the laboratory of Maximo.
Yes, there you will find much diversion.
Goodbye, my esteemed friend.
May God be with you.
The Marquis goes towards the garden. Scene 11. Elektra, Pantoja. Pantoja with vivacity.
What was he saying? What was this corrupter of innocence telling you?
Nothing. Stories. Funny anecdotes.
Ah, stories. Have no confidence in funny anecdotes and pleasant tales, for these jasmines hide a poisonous sting. I noticed that you were disturbed, as when one hears the gliding of a serpent among the bushes.
Oh, no.
The uneasiness which unseemly conversation produces will be calmed by my beneficent and healthful words.
You are a poet, Sir Pantoja, and I am pleased to listen to you.
Pantoja, pointing out a chair to her, they both sit down.
My daughter, I am going to give you an explanation of the intense affection which you have noticed in me. Have you noticed it?
Yes, sir.
An explanation which is equivalent to revealing a secret.
Elektra, much frightened.
Oh, heavens, I am trembling.
Be calm, my daughter. Listen first to that which is for me very sad. Elektra, I have been very wicked.
But you really give the impression of a saint.
I was very wicked. I say, on one occasion of my life.
Sighing.
Oh, it was many years ago.
Elektra with interest.
How many? Can I remember the time when you were so wicked, Don Salvador?
No. When I debased myself, when I blinded myself in sin, you were not yet born.
But I was born.
Pantoja, after a pause.
Of course.
I was born. For heaven's sake, Sir Pantoja, finish quickly.
Your confusion indicates to me that we must turn our eyes from the past. The present is for us very satisfactory.
Why?
Because in me you will have a support, a protector for your whole life. An ineffable happiness it is for me to care for a being so noble and beautiful, to defend you from all harm, to guard you, to watch over you, to guide you, in order that you may keep yourself always virtuous and pure, in order that neither shadow nor breath of evil may ever touch you. You are a child that seems an angel. I am not satisfied that you seem so. I wish you to be one.
Elektra, coldly.
An angel that belongs to you. And in this I am to see an act of charity, extraordinary and sublime.
It is not charity, it is duty. To my duty to protect you there is added your right to be protected.
This confidence, this authority...
is born of my intense affection, as force is born of heat. And my protection is the work of my conscience.
Elektra rises with great agitation. Moving away from Pantoja, she exclaims aside.
Two! Heavens! Two protectors! And this one wishes to force me. Horrible confusion.
aloud.
Sir Pantoja, I respect you, I admire your virtues, but your authority over me I do not see clearly, and pardon my boldness. Obedience, submission, I owe only to my aunt.
It is all the same. Evarista does me the honor to consult with me in all her affairs. Obeying her, you obey me.
And my aunt wishes, too, that I should become an angel, her angel, your angel.
The angel of everyone, of God, chiefly. Be convinced that you have fallen into good hands, and be satisfied, my dear daughter. Let yourself grow up in virtue, in purity.
Electra, with displeasure.
Very good, sir. Let them purify me. But am I very wicked?
You may come to be so. To prevent a disease is more prudent than to cure it after it has entered into the system.
Alas for me!
Raising her eyes and remaining as in an ecstasy, she utters a deep sigh. Pause.
Why do you sigh so?
Let my heart relieve itself. The consciences of others weigh heavily upon me.
Scene 12. Electra, Pantoja, Evarista in the background.
Friend Pantoja, Mother Barbara de la Cruz is waiting to take leave of you and receive your final orders.
Oh, I forgot. I am coming at once.
Aside to Evarista.
We have been talking. Watch carefully. We must look out for evil influences.
Before leaving at the back, the Marquis and Maximo come in at the right. Scene 13. Electra, Evarista, the Marquis, Maximo.
I am a little late.
Not at all. You were in Maximo's study?
Two groups are formed. Electra and Maximo at the left, Evarista and the Marquis at the right.
Yes, madam. That man is a wonder.
Continues, thinking over what he has seen in the laboratory. Electra sighing.
Yes, Maximo. I have to consult with you about a serious matter.
Maximo, with much interest.
Tell me, quickly.
Electra, looking cautiously at the other group.
I cannot now.
When?
I don't know. I don't know when I shall be able to tell you. It isn't a thing that can be told in two words.
Ah, poor little girl, that which I told you. Are you beginning to note already the serious things of life, its bitternesses, its duties?
Perhaps.
Maximo, looking at her fixedly, with great interest.
I note in your face a cloud of sadness, of fear. A great novelty for you.
They wish to annihilate me, to enslave me, to reduce me to something angelical. I do not understand it.
Maximo, with energy.
Do not consent to it, for heaven's sake. Electra, defend yourself.
What do you advise me to do to avoid it?
Maximo, without hesitation.
Independence.
Independence?
Emancipation. More clearly, insubordination.
You mean that I shall be able to do anything I take a notion to play all I wish, to enter into your house as into a promised land, to throw things around with your children, and take them into the garden with me, or wherever I like.
All this and more.
Be careful what you are saying.
I know what I am saying.
But you have recommended me to do quite the contrary.
Maximo, looking at her fixedly.
In your face and in your eyes, I see a radical change in the conditions of your life. You are afraid, Electra.
Yes.
Fearful.
You,
doubting what verb to use, starts to say love and does not dare.
Desire something with great energy.
Electra, effusively.
Yes.
Pause.
And you tell me against fears and desires, insubordination.
Yes, give your impulses free rein in order that what is in you may show itself and we may know what you are.
What I am? Do you wish to know?
Your heart.
My secrets?
Your heart. In it is everything.
Electra, noticing that Evarista is watching her.
Hush! They are looking at us.
Scene 14. The same. Don Urbano, Pantoja at the back.
Shall we lunch?
Pantoja to Evarista, startled, seeing Electra with Maximo.
Why, daughter, you leave her alone with Mephistopheles?
There is no cause for alarm, friend Pantoja.
Marquis, laughing.
Of course not, for this Mephistopheles is a saint.
Gives his arm to Evarista. Pantoja imperiously taking Electra by the hand to lead her away.
With me.
Electra, going with Pantoja, turns her head to look at Maximo. Maximo, looking at Electra and Pantoja.
With you? We shall see with whom.
Maximo and Don Urbano go out last. End of Act One. Act Two of Electra by Benito Pérez Galdós, translated by Charles Alfred Turrell. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Act Two. The Same Decoration. Scene One. Evarista, Don Urbano, seated together at the table, occupied with business. Balbina, who is serving the lady with a cup of broth. Don Urbano, preparing to write.
What have you said to the rector of the patrocinio?
Evarista, with a cup in her hand.
Why, you know already that the plan and the estimate suit us, and that now we shall close with the contractor.
Don't forget that the proposition of the latter reaches...
Reading a paper.
320,000 pesetas.
No matter. There still remains to us enough to continue helping the ambulance station.
To Balbina, who takes away the cup.
Don't forget what I told you to do.
I shall watch it, madam. I think there is no harm in this play of Miss Electra. If she receive letters and notes from a suitor, it is for pastime and to have another motive for laughter and gaiety.
But how do they get to the house?
The letters of these dandies? I don't know yet, but I shall watch Patros, for it seems to me.
Take great care and tell me what you discover.
You may be sure I will, madam.
Exit Balbina. Scene Two. The same. Maximo, at the back, in haste with plants and papers.
Do I disturb you?
No, my son. Come in.
2 minutes, aunt.
Do you come from the ministry?
I have just had a conference with the Bilbaenos. Today is a day of trial for me. Excessive work, 1,000 affairs, and in addition the house turned upside down.
Why, what has happened? Balbina told me that you dismissed your servants yesterday.
They served me miserably. They robbed me. I am alone with the clerk and the nurse.
Come and eat here.
And leave the children there? If I bring them, they will bother you and will upset the house.
Don't bring them, no. I adore children, but I don't like them near me. They throw all my things around and soil everything. The confusion of their stamping, their loud laughing, and their quarreling drives me crazy. Then the fear that they will fall, that the cats will scratch them, that they will get wet, that they will bump their heads. Ugh.
I should prefer that you send me a cook.
Henrietta can go. Tell her, Urbano. We shall not forget.
Maximo, preparing to leave.
All right.
Wait a minute. It seems your affairs are getting along well. You know what I have told you. If the wonderful magician needs more capital for the exploiting of his inventions, he has only to call upon us.
Thank you, aunt. I have at my disposal all the money I need.
Within a few years, the magician will be richer than we.
It might happen.
Fruit of his peculiar intelligence.
Maximo, with modesty.
No, of perseverance, of laborious patience.
Oh, I should say. You work brutally.
As is necessary, aunt, through duty, and a little more for pleasure, for recreation, for scientific enthusiasm.
It is really a monomania, an intoxication.
Evarista, in a sermon-like tone.
Ah, no. It is ambition, the cursed ambition which upsets so many and, in the end, causes their ruin.
A very legitimate ambition, aunt. You see that?
Evarista, taking the words from his mouth.
The eagerness, the thirst for riches in order to satisfy with them the appetite for pleasure,
Pleasure, pleasure, pleasure. That is what you want and for which you live in continual movement, comprising in the struggle your nature, stomach, brain, heart. You do not think of the brevity of life, nor of the vanity of desires for temporal things. You do not succeed in convincing yourself that everything will remain here.
Maximo, gracefully, impatient to leave.
Everything will remain here except myself, for I am going right now.
José announcing.
The Marquis of Ronda.
Maximo stopping.
Ah, then I cannot go without greeting him.
Evarista gathering up the papers.
God doesn't wish us to work today.
I can guess what he is coming for.
Let him come in, José.
José goes out.
He comes to invite you to the dedication of the new convent of La Esclavitud, founded by Virginia. He told me of it last night.
Ah, yes. But is it today?
Scene 3. Evarista, Don Urbano, Maximo, the Marquis. Marquis, bowing meekly.
Illustrious friend, Urbano.
To Maximo.
How are you? I did not think I should find the magician here.
The magician salutes you and disappears.
One moment, my friend.
Detaining him.
Why, yes, Marquis, we shall go.
You knew about it already?
At what hour is it?
At 5 sharp.
To Maximo.
I do not invite you, for I know that you haven't time for social life.
Alas, no. I wasn't expecting you today.
How? Since we have a religious and secular holiday? Well, tonight you shall not get rid of me.
Evarista, lightly mocking.
We have been noticing, with great pleasure, of course, the frequency of the visits of the Marquis to the laboratory of the great sorcerer.
The Marquis honors me with his friendship and with the interest he displays in my studies.
I have acquired a sudden passion for machinery and electrical phenomena. Whims of age.
Don Urbano to Maximo.
Well, you have a good pupil.
God knows.
Maliciously.
God knows who is the pupil and who is the master.
Apropos of the master. I am sorry that since he is present, I am deprived of saying all the bad things that come to me.
Go along, Maximo. Go along so that we may say bad things about you.
I am going. Let the evil tongues wag as they please.
To the Marquis.
Farewell as always.
To his aunt.
Goodbye, aunt.
God be with you, my son.
Marquis to Maximo, who leaves.
Until tonight, if they let me.
To Evarista.
Extraordinary man. I admired him by reputation, and knowing him now, and appreciating for myself his high qualities, I maintain that there is no one who can equal him.
In the scientific world.
In all fields, madam.
Certainly as for intelligence.
Marquis, with enthusiasm.
And as for heart, well, who is there more noble, more sincere?
Evarista, not wishing to continue a delicate discussion.
Good, Marquis, good.
Changing the subject.
So you were saying that we should be there at 5?
Exactly. I shall count on you and Electra.
I don't know whether we ought to take her.
Oh, I was charged especially with asking the presence of the girl at this solemnity. And I put on the airs of a good diplomat, declaring that I should succeed. Virginia desires to make her acquaintance.
In that case.
Promise not to put me bad.
Oh, you may count on Electra.
There will be a good many people there.
Rises to leave.
It will be a brilliant affair.
Goodbye, then. I have to go to the Otumbas. I shall come by here.
Here's the voice of Electra at the left, gaily chattering and laughing. The Marquis stops on hearing her. Scene 4. The same, Electra. Electra within.
Ha! Darling, another kiss. Silly, silly, both of us, but we understand each other.
Appears at the left with a large, handsome doll, which she kisses and rocks in her arms. Stops as if ashamed.
Child, what are you doing?
Don't scold her.
Mademoiselle Lulu and I were passing the time telling stories.
She talks nonsense today.
Electra, going away, talking secretly to the doll. The rest watch her.
Lulu, how pretty you are. But he is nicer. How happy will my love be with you, and I with both of you.
She continues to be so playful. So...
Since yesterday we have noticed in her a sadness which troubles me.
Sadness. Idealism.
And now you see.
Marquis, affectionately, going to her.
Electra, my dear child.
Electra, putting the doll's face to that of the Marquis.
Come, mademoiselle, don't be bashful. Give the Marquis a kiss.
Before the Marquis can kiss the doll, Electra gives him a light rap with the doll's head.
Ah, rogue! You hit me!
Stroking Electra's chin.
Lulu will not be angry if I say that I like her big friend better.
Both have the same amount of brains.
And what were you talking about to your doll?
Sometimes I tell her my troubles.
You troubles?
Yes, I, troubles. And when you see us so silent, we are thinking of past things.
The past interests you. Sign of reflection.
What are you saying? Past things?
Of the time when I was born.
With gravity.
The day in which I came into the world was a very sad day, wasn't it? Some of you remember.
Why, how absurdly you talk, my daughter. Aren't you ashamed for the Marquis to see you so silly?
Do you not believe that the fools the most foolish, and the children the most childish, do their simple acts with some reason?
Very true.
And what sense is there in this play so unsuited to your age?
Electra, looking at the Marquis, who is smiling.
I can't tell you now.
That means that I should go.
Child.
Yes, I am going. I am sorry that my affairs do not allow me time to enjoy the graces of this child. Goodbye, Electra. I shall return at 5 to take you with me.
Me?
Yes, daughter. We are going to the dedication of Las Esclavas.
I too?
Now you may go and get ready.
Will there be many people?
Frightened?
Oh, a lot of people make me afraid. I like solitude.
Why, we shall be just like a family. Well, I must not stay longer.
A goodbye, Marquis.
Marquis to Electra.
At 5, child, and we must learn to be punctual.
Exit at the rear with Don Urbano. Scene 5. Evarista, Electra.
Explain to me now why you are so silly and playful.
You see, aunt, I had a doubt. What shall I say? A problem.
You problems.
Yes, in the plural. Problems. For it is not one alone.
God help you.
And I was trying to have someone solve them with a few words.
Who?
Electra, sighing.
Ugh, a person who is no longer in this world.
Child.
My mother. Don't be astonished. My mother can tell me, and counsel me. Don't you believe that people who are in the other world can come to ours?
Gesture of incredulity on the part of Evarista.
You don't believe it. I do. I believe it because I have seen it. I have seen my mother.
Oh, Virgin of Carmen, how bad your poor head is.
When I was a little girl, so big.
In the Ursuline convent at Bayonne?
Yes, my mother used to appear to me.
In dreams, of course.
No, no, when I was as awake as I am now.
Leaves the doll on a chair.
Electra, take care what you are saying.
When I was sad, alone, and sick, when someone hurt me, making me understand my unfortunate situation in the world, my mother used to come to console me. At first I saw her vaguely, fading away, confusing herself with objects nearby and far away. She advanced like a light, trembling. So. Then she didn't tremble, aunt. She was a still form,
Still, a sad image. It was my mother. I could not doubt it. In the beginning I saw her dressed as a great lady, very elegantly. Then one day I saw her in a nun's garb, her face in a white hood, her body clothed with the black serge. She had a majesty, a beauty that one cannot imagine who has not seen her.
Poor girl, don't get delirious.
When she got near me, she would reach out her arms as if she would embrace me. She spoke to me in a voice very sweet, very distant, soft. I don't know how to explain it. I asked her questions, and she used to answer me.
Greater incredulity on the part of Evarista.
But you don't believe it.
Go on, daughter, go on.
In the Ursuline convent, I had a lovely doll that I called Lulu, too. And see how strange, aunt. Whenever I went through the garden, late in the afternoon, alone, with the doll in my arms, both of us melancholy, looking at the sky, the vision of my mother was sure. It never failed. At first, among the trees, like a figure formed by groups of leaves, then, revealing itself clearly, and advancing towards me between the dark trunks.
And later, when you were older, when you lived in Ondaye, did she come too?
In the first years, not afterwards. I used to play then with live dolls, the little ones of my cousin Rosora, a boy and a girl, who were always with me. They adored me, and I them. At night in the solitude of my room, the children asleep, they there, I here.
Indicating the place of the two beds?
My mother used to pass between the two beds and approaching me.
Oh, don't go on, for heaven's sake. You make me afraid. But these visions, did they stop when you got older?
When I quit having dolls and children at my side. That is why I want to become a child again, and I try to go back to the age of innocence, with the hope that, being what I was then, my mother will come to me again, and will answer all that I should like to ask her, and may give me counsel.
And what doubts have you to...
Electra, looking at the floor.
Doubts. Things that I don't know and should like to know.
What nonsense! And what is this thing so serious about which you need counsel and advice?
Oh, a thing!
Hesitates, is almost on the point of telling.
What? Tell me.
A thing.
With childlike timidity, handling the doll and without daring to declare her secret.
A thing.
Evarista, severe but affectionately.
Oh, such childishness is intolerable.
Takes the doll away from her.
Alas, Electra, foolish child, you are a model of intelligence and grace when you are not the image of selfishness. Angels and demons are struggling for your heart. We must intervene, my daughter. We must mediate in this struggle, driving away the demons so that they may not fall upon you and cause you sorrow.
Kisses her.
Come, be serious. You need to occupy yourself with something to distract your imagination. Don't forget that at 5. Go and get ready now.
Yes, aunt.
You have plenty of time. 3/4 of an hour.
I shall be ready.
And no jests, Electra. Be careful.
Exit at the left with a doll in her arms, dangling it. Scene 6. Electra, Patros. Electra, looking after the doll.
Poor Lulu, how she dangles.
Imitating the position of the doll and feeling the sore shoulder.
Oh, how it hurts!
Sits down, thinking.
And he waiting for me. How sad it was to leave him. How he cried and threw out his arms to me. I promised to return.
Patros, appearing cautiously at the door.
Miss Electra.
Come in.
Patras, advancing with caution.
Is there anyone here?
We are alone.
There is no opportunity like this, Miss Electra. Now or never.
Have you come from there?
Yes, from there. Many gentlemen who were talking numbers. Millions and more millions. Inside, nobody.
Electra, hesitating.
Dare we?
There is no danger.
Virgin of Carmen, protect me.
Turning to the garden entrance. Electra stops, frightened.
Wait, wouldn't it be better for us to go out on the other side? Perhaps my aunt might be at the dining room window.
She might be. Let's go around this way.
To the left.
This way. courage and valor, with caution.
Exit both running at the left. Scene 7. Don Urbano. Jose, who enters at the back just as the girls leave.
Who went out there?
It was Patros, sir.
So, how many?
There are 5 now, who are making love to the young lady. 5 that I have seen. God knows how many more there are.
And what is to be done? Do they walk around the house?
2 in the morning, 2 in the afternoon, and a young fellow at night.
Have you noticed whether there is any communication between the window of Electra's room and the street, by means of a basket or a telephone cord?
No, I haven't seen anything of the kind. But I think it would be well to put the young lady in an inside room.
To the left.
And do some of these fellows come into the garden secretly?
I'd give them a good drubbing.
All right. Keep on watching.
Enter Cuesta at the rear. Scene 8. Don Urbano, Cuesta, with papers and letters.
Leonardo, thank God.
I told you I couldn't come in the morning.
To Jose, giving him a letter.
Have this registered, quickly. Then you will bring me some more letters.
Exit Jose. Don Urbano taking a paper that Cuesta gives him.
What is this?
The receipt for the 100,000 odd. Sign now, a receipt for 67,000.
All right. To send to Rome?
And Evarista?
Dressing.
I know already that you are going to the dedication of the La Esclavitude, and that you are going to take Electra.
It is certain that we can expect nothing good of this girl. Every day she shows more extravagances, new frivolities.
Cuesta, with vivacity.
Which indicate nothing bad.
They are like symptoms, you see. Like symptoms. On this account, Evarista, who is foresight itself, has thought of submitting her to the healthful regime of San Jose de Penitencia.
Allow me, my dear Urbano, to dissent from your opinions. You will say that I should not meddle.
On the contrary, as a good friend of the family, you may give us your opinion. Advise us.
This dragging into the convent life, young girls, who have not shown a decided vocation, is very serious, and you should not think it strange if some oppose.
Who?
How should I know? Someone. There is in the life of this girl an unknown factor. Some fine day, it may happen. I cannot be sure what will happen. Some fine day, when you pull the string to shut the girl up against her will, a voice may say, "Stop, sir. Stop, madam. Stop."
And we shall reply, "Very well, sir unknown factor. Here you have her. Relieve us from a troublesome and vexing guardianship."
Cuesta, feeling great fatigue, sits down.
This is just a supposition, Urbano, a conjecture.
Are you ill? Do you need anything?
No. This heart of mine is not as strong as my will.
Rest, man. Why do you not lie down a while?
Why? Don't you know how much I have to do?
Taking out some papers.
Right away, 2 very urgent letters. That must get off today.
Write them here.
Fixing a place at the table and taking away some books and papers.
All right. I'll install myself here.
I, too, am very much behind. I have 1,000 little things.
Don't bother about me.
Writing.
Excuse me, Leonardo. Evarista will be out before long.
Cuesta, without looking at him.
Goodbye.
Exit Don Urbano at back. Scene 9. Cuesta, Electra, Patros, who appear at the left door as if reconnoitering.
Be careful, Patros. It will be hard to get him through here.
Patros, recognizing Cuesta, whose back she sees writing.
Don Leonardo.
Hush! The best way is to leave him in your room until tonight, while I have to go to this cursed dedication.
Cuesta, hearing voices, turns around.
Ah, Electra.
Do we bother you, Don Leonardo?
No, my daughter. Will you do me the favor to wait a moment until I finish this letter? I want to talk with you.
I shall be here, sir.
Aside to Patros.
What a nuisance.
Aloud?
We only came to look for a paper and pencil so that Patros could note down.
Takes a paper and pencil from the table. Aside to Patros.
Take good care of him for me. Do. Oh, how pretty he was sleeping. That little mouth and those dirty hands and such black fingernails, as if he had been scratching in the ground. Oh, I could eat him up.
And his curly hair and his little feet.
Electra, with an effusion of affection.
I shall go crazy. Take good care of him, Patros. Watch that.
I'm taking him 2 little rolls now.
No, no, they will hurt his stomach. Take him some soup.
And how shall I get it?
That's true. Ah, ask for a cup of milk for me.
That's it. I shall give it to him as soon as he wakes up.
Here are the paper and pencil for your scribbling. That is what amuses you most. Then tonight, watching an opportunity, we shall take him to my room, and he shall sleep with me.
Questa, finishing the letter.
Now it is finished.
Excuse me a moment, Don Leonardo.
Aside to Patros.
Don't leave him. Be careful. If Don Leonardo doesn't keep me long, before I dress, I shall come and give him a kiss.
Patros.
Sir.
Will you take this letter to the post office?
Right away.
Exit. Scene 10. Questa, Electra. Questa, seizing her hands.
Playful little woman. Come here. What a pleasure to see you.
Do you like me very much, Don Leonardo? If you only knew how it pleases me for people to like me.
The most important thing, my daughter, is for you to be serious, that God-fearing people should find nothing to censure. They have told me, I believe they have exaggerated, that lovers are swarming around you.
Alas, yes, I can scarcely count them, but there is only one of them that I like.
Only one, and that is?
Oh, wouldn't you like to know?
Do I know him?
I should say you do.
Has he declared himself in a formal manner?
Why, he hasn't declared himself at all. He hasn't said anything to me. Yet.
The fellow is timid. And you call him a lover?
I shouldn't give him that name.
And you love him? And you know or suspect that he loves you?
That's it. I suspect it. I am not sure of it.
And you will not tell me? Me, who?
Oh, no.
Oh, do have confidence in me.
I cannot now. I must go and dress.
All right. We shall talk about it later.
Electra, timidly, looking towards the back.
Is my aunt coming?
Go and dress, and tomorrow.
Yes, tomorrow. Goodbye.
Runs off to the right. Moved by a sudden idea, turns half around.
First I have to...
Aside.
I cannot conquer the temptation. I want to give him another kiss.
Goes running to the left. Questa follows her with his eyes. Sighs. Scene 11. Questa, Don Urbano, Evarista. Afterwards, Electra. Questa gathering up his papers.
What happiness would be mine if I could love her openly?
Evarista dressed for the street.
Pardon the delay, Don Leonardo. My husband has told me that we are arranging an extensive transaction.
Don Urbano giving Questa a receipt.
Here. Yeah.
I shall not be astonished to see you come in with another load of money. God sends it, God receives it.
Electra appears at the door on the left. On seeing her aunt, she hesitates and does not dare to enter. Finally, she tries to escape, but Evarista sees her and stops her.
Oh, you scamp! Why are you not dressed? Where have you been?
In the ironing room. I went to have Patros iron me a jabot.
And you are so calm about it.
Noticing that there is a letter in one of Electra's pockets.
What have you here?
Takes it.
A letter.
Affairs of youth.
You cannot imagine, my friend Questa, how this child worries me with her childishness, which is not so innocent either.
Gives the letter to her husband.
You read it.
Let's see.
Don Urbano reads.
My dear young lady, it seems to me that in your bewitching face...
Evarista mocking.
How pretty.
Electra restrains her laughter with difficulty.
that in your bewitching face the Supreme Creator has written the problem of the...
Without understanding the following word. Electroprompting.
Of the cosmos.
That's it. Of the cosmos. Symbolizing in your luminous glances, in your divine mouth, the powerful physical agent that...
Evarista snatching the letter.
What unseemly nonsense!
Don Urbano discovering another letter in the other pocket.
Why, here's another!
Takes it.
Let's see this one.
My daughter, you are a real letterbox.
Questa reading.
Heartless Electra, with what words shall I express my despair, my madness, my frenzy?
Enough. This is certainly not innocent.
Troubled, examining the letters.
I will wager there are more.
Evarista, indulgence.
Aunt, don't be angry.
Not be angry? I will settle it with you. Now go and dress.
Don Urbano, looking at his watch.
It is almost time.
I shall be here in a minute.
Go along, go along.
Glad to see herself free, Electra runs to her room. Scene 12. Questa, Don Urbano, Evarista, Pantoja. Evarista, with sadness and dismay.
Now you see, Don Leonardo.
The tranquility in which she allowed her secrets to be exposed shows that there is in all this little or no evil intent.
Alas, I do not think the same way, no.
Pantoja at the back, somewhat out of breath.
Here they are, and Questa too, just so one cannot talk freely.
Evarista, pleased to see him.
Ah, at last you come.
They form two groups, at the left Questa seated, Don Urbano standing, at the right Pantoja and Evarista seated.
I have come to tell you of very serious things.
Evarista frightened.
Oh, dear, God's will be done.
Pantoja repeating the phrase with reservations.
God's will be done? Yes, but let our will be the same as God's, and let us use our will to bring about good, cost what it may.
Your strength fortifies my soul. Well, and what?
Today, at the requiescence, they talked about the girl in the most shameful terms. They said that, pursued most indecorously by a whole crowd of lovers, she delights in receiving and sending letters at all hours of the day.
Unfortunately, Salvador, the frivolities of the girl are such that, although I love her so much, I cannot come to her defense.
Pantoja anxiously.
Well, listen further, and you will see that human malice has no limits. Last night, the Marquis of Ronda, in a company at his house before Virginia, his saintly wife, and other persons of great respectability, did not cease to praise the charms of Electra in a very worldly and repugnant manner.
Let us have patience, my friend.
Patience? Yes, patience, a virtue which is worth very little if it is not inspired by resolution. Let us determine, my dear friend, to put Electra where she will not see examples of levity, not hear any words spoken with malicious accent.
Where she will breathe an atmosphere of austere virtue.
Where the buzz of the poisonous and immodest suitors will not disturb her. In the critical age of the formation of character, we ought to preserve her from the great danger, madam, from the terrible danger.
Which is?
Man. There is no greater evil than man. Man, when he is not good. I know it from myself. I have been my own master. My wildness, which I cured by the grace of God, and afterwards my sorrowful convalescence, taught me the medicine for souls. Leave it to me. I will save the girl.
Don Urbano interrupts him, passing to the group on the right. Don Urbano giving meaning to his words.
Do you know what Questa tells me? Well, that among this multitude of lovers, there is one preferred. Electra herself confessed it.
And who is it?
Passes from the right to the left of the stage. Pantoja and Urbano remaining at the right. Don Urbano to Pantoja.
This might change the terms of the problem.
Pantoja with ill humor.
But what does this preference signify? Is it a pure affection, or an immoderate, feverish passion, one of those that are the very gravest symptoms of the madness of the age?
Very excited, raising his tone.
For it must be known, Urbano, it must be known.
We shall know it.
Pantoja, passing to the side of Cuesta.
And you, friend Cuesta, didn't you question her?
Evarista, in the center to Don Urbano.
Try to find out.
Cuesta, somewhat vexed already, talking to Pantoja.
It seems to me that you display an undue zeal, and not at all to be desired.
Pantoja, with a suavity that does not hide his haughtiness.
My zeal, my dear Leonardo, is what it should be.
Cuesta, a little hurt.
I, as a friend of the family, believed.
Pantoja, taking Don Urbano aside to the right.
Cuesta mixes too much in things that do not concern him.
Cuesta to Evarista, without heeding whether Pantoja hears him.
Our good Pantoja interferes too much in other people's business.
Evarista, without knowing what explanation to give him.
It is that, as our very old and loyal friend...
So am I.
Don Urbano, looking towards the back of stage.
Here is the Marquis now.
Scene 13. The same, the Marquis.
Good greetings to you all.
Pantoja aside.
Bad enough since he comes.
Marquis, after bowing to Evarista.
And Electra?
She will be here in a moment.
Marquis, bowing to all.
We haven't much time left.
It is time now.
Pantoja, impatient, waits for Electra at the door of her room. Cuesta is talking with Don Urbano. Scene 14. The same, Electra. Pantoja, with joy, announcing her.
Here she is.
Electra enters at the right, dressed with most elegant simplicity and distinction. Marquis, joyful and eulogistic.
Oh, how elegant!
Electra, pleased, turning around so that they can see her from all sides.
Gentlemen, how do you like it?
Divine.
Ideal.
Very good, my daughter.
Pantoja, displeased at the eulogies of Electra.
Are we going?
They start to go. Scene 15. The same. Balbina, who interrupts brusquely the scene, entering at the left, hurried and out of breath.
Madam! Madam!
General alarm. All except Electra.
What is it?
Oh, what has the young lady done?
Electra aside, stamping her foot.
They have discovered me.
Heavens! Heavens! What pranks she does think of!
Laughing.
Fine! In the name of the Father.
Evarista, impatiently.
Tell it.
I will confess if you will let me. It was that...
She went to the house of Don Maximo, and she stole, for it was like a robbery. A very funny one, surely.
But what?
The little boy.
All looking at Electra, who soon recovers from her fright and adopts a calm and grave attitude.
But my daughter...
Child, child!
He was sound asleep in the house. They entered on tiptoe, the young lady and that crazy Petros. They carried him away and brought him here.
It is ridiculous.
Pantoja, hiding his irritation.
And moreover, very unbecoming.
Electra, effusively.
And I love him so much, and he does me.
Marquis, with enthusiasm.
What a girl!
She deserves indulgence.
Maximo will be furious.
José ran to tell him. We shall know soon.
And where is the little fellow?
The young lady hid him in Petra's room with the idea of carrying him to her room tonight and keep him there with her.
Laughter of the gentleman except Pantoja, who frowns.
The child woke up a while ago and Petra gave him a bun to entertain him. I heard him, and I hurried there to find out. Holy Virgin, I want to take him, and he wouldn't let me. I shall have to whip him.
Electra running to the left with instinctive impulse.
My darling.
Pandoja wishes to stop her.
No.
Evarista seizes her by the arm.
Wait.
Balbina from the door on the left.
You can hear him crying from here.
My poor little fellow.
Have him taken home.
Nobody shall touch him. He is mine.
She breaks loose forcibly from Evarista and Pantoja, who try to stop her, and runs quickly out at the left. Scene 16. The same. Jose. Pantoja, angry, withdrawing to the right.
What a lack of sense, of dignity!
Jose, hurriedly from the garden.
Madam!
What did Maximo say?
He didn't know anything about it. He was with some gentlemen. When I told him, he began to laugh, but so tranquilly. He says that the young lady will take care of the baby.
Calmness, indeed.
Evarista to Jose.
Go take him home. That's the way to teach this silly girl.
I should say, let her enjoy a plaything so harmless.
Scene 17. The same. Electra at the left with a child in her arms. The child is about 2 years old.
My darling boy.
Child, for heaven's sake, put him down and let's go.
Don Urbano in a hurry.
We shall be late.
Cuesta to the Marquis.
It is a trait of motherhood. I applaud it.
And I think it is divine.
Evarista, wishing to take the child from her.
Come, girl.
Electra, with a light step, gets away from them. The child clings to her neck.
No, I can't leave him now. No, no!
Take him, Balbina.
No, I say no.
Goes from one side to the other, seeking refuge.
Give him to me.
No.
Pantoja, commandingly to Jose.
You take him.
No, he is mine.
But child, we have to go.
Go on, then.
Her hat bothers her, for it hides the child's forehead. With a quick movement, she takes it off and throws it down. She continues walking with the child, fleeing from those who try to take it.
Enough. Are you coming or not?
Electra, paying no attention, talking to the child, who throws his arms around her neck and kisses her.
Go to sleep, my dear. Don't be afraid, little one. I'll not let you go.
Well, are we going or not?
I'm not going. Are you hungry, sweetheart? Are you thirsty? See how the little fellow clings to me, begging me not to leave him. Selfish people. Don't you know that he hasn't any mother?
But he has someone to take care of him.
Evarista commanding the servants.
Oh, that's enough. Take him home at once.
Electra, resolutely, without letting them take the child.
Home! Home!
With a decided step, and looking at no one, she runs towards the garden and goes out. All look at her, not daring to follow.
What a scandal!
What a lack of sense!
Marquis aside.
She has plenty of sense. She has found her way.
End of Act 2. Act 3 of Electra by Benito Pérez Galdós, translated by Charles Alfred Girel. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Act 3. Laboratory of Maximo. In the background, occupying a large part of the wall, a partition, the lower portion of which is of wood, the upper portion of glass, which separates the stage from a large room in which there are various pieces of apparatus for producing electrical energy. The door in this partition communicates with the street. At the right, in front, a passageway which communicates with the garden of García Yuste.
Further back, a door leading to the private apartments of Maximo and to the kitchen. Between the door and the passageway, a bookcase. At the left, a door leading to the room where the assistants are working. Beside this door, a case filled with physical apparatus and objects for scientific use. At the back, on both sides of the partition, and in the wooden base, shelves with flasks of various substances and books. In the angle at the right, a small sideboard. At the left of the stage, the laboratory table, containing objects indicated in the dialogue, forming an angle with it, the balances and a concrete base. In the center, a small dining table, four chairs. Scene 1. Maximo, working on a problem, very intent on his task. Electra, standing arranging the many objects that are on the table, books, scale pans, test tubes, etc. Dressed with domestic simplicity and wearing a white apron.
To me, Electra, the double story which you have told me, the supposed authority of two gentlemen, is a fact that lacks any positive value.
Without raising his eyes from the paper. Electra sighing.
God grant that it be so.
All reduces itself to two platonic paternities with no legal effect. So far, the worst is the authority which Pantoja wishes to assume.
An authority that overwhelms me, that gives me no rest. I beg you, let us not talk of this matter. It spoils for me the joy I feel being here in your house.
Really?
Yes, and more. I get my head and my nerves in such a strange state that I have already told you that on certain occasions in my life there takes possession of me an intense desire to see my mother, as I used to see her in my childhood. Well, when this tyranny of Pantejo increases, this desire fills my whole soul, and with it I feel a nervous and mental disturbance that announces to me.
The vision of your mother? Child, this is not proper for a strong mind. Learn to control your imagination. So, to work. Idleness is the first disturber of our minds.
Electra, with much animation,
I am doing what you told me.
Takes some flasks of mineral substances and carries them to one of the cases.
This in its place, so I do not think of the fury of my aunt when she knows.
Maximo, buried in his work.
She will be pleased. As if the folly of yesterday were not enough, when you carried off the child and bringing him back stayed longer than usual, today, to make amends, you have come to my house, and there you are so cool. Thank God for the absence of our uncle and aunt, both of them invited by the Requesens for the distribution of prizes and to lunch at Santa Clara. They don't know the jump the doll of their house has made over to mine.
You advised me to become insubordinate.
Of course. I have been the instigator of your transgression, and I am not sorry for it.
My conscience tells me that there is nothing wrong in it.
You are in the house and in the company of an honorable man.
Electra, talking without stopping her work.
Of course, and furthermore, you being busy with your work, alone, without a servant, and I having nothing to do, it is very natural that—
That you should come to take care of me and of my children? If that is not logic, we may say that logic has disappeared from the world.
Poor little ones. Everybody knows that I adore them. They are my passion, my weakness.
Maximo, absorbed in a calculation, does not hear what she says.
And it even seems to me—
She approaches the table, carrying some books that were out of place. Maximo, arousing from his absorption—
What?
That their mother did not love them more than I do.
Maximo, satisfied with the result of his calculation, reads aloud a sum.
0, 310, and 8. Do me the favor to bring me the table of resistances. That red book.
Electra, going to the case on the right.
This one?
Higher up.
Yes, yes. How stupid.
Getting the book, gives it to him.
It is wonderful that in so short a time you know my books and their places.
Don't you think I have arranged them very well?
Thank God, I see in my study cleanliness and order.
Electra, well satisfied.
It is true, Maximo, that I am not absolutely, absolutely useless.
Maximo, looking at her fixedly.
Nothing exists in creation that does not serve for something. Who told you that God did not create you for great ends? Who told you that you are not—
Electra, anxiously.
What?
A great soul, beautiful and noble, still somewhat smothered. between the tow and the sawdust of a doll.
Electra very happy?
Oh, if I only were all that.
Maximo rises, takes some bars of metal from the case at the left and examines them.
Don't tell me so, for I shall be crazy with joy. May I sing now?
Yes, child, yes.
Humming, Electra repeats over the andante of a sonata.
Good music is like the spur of lazy ideas that do not flow easily. It is also like a hook that draws out those that cleave to the depths of the imagination. Sing, girl, sing.
Continues to be absorbed in his work. Electra at the case in the rear.
I'm going to arrange all this. The metalloids go on this side. I know them very well by the color of the labels. How the work entertains me. I could stay here the whole day long.
Maximo gaily.
Well, comrade.
Electra going to his side.
What has the wonderful magician to command?
I do not command yet. I ask.
Takes a flask which contains metal filings or shavings.
Since the playful Electra wishes to work with me, will she do me the favor to weigh 30 grams of this metal?
Oh, yes.
Yesterday you learned to weigh with the balances.
Electra pleased, getting ready.
Yes, yes. Give it to me. Let me do it.
Pouring out the metal on the pan, she admires its beauty.
How pretty. What is this?
Aluminum. It is like you. It weighs little.
I weigh little?
But it is very firm.
Looking at her face.
Are you very firm?
In some things that I keep to myself, I am very firm, even to severity, and I believe, if occasion arose, I should be so even to martyrdom.
Continues weighing without interrupting the work.
What things are those?
It is no matter to you.
Maximo, absorbed in his work.
All right. Now weigh me 70 grams of this.
Giving her another flask.
You are like copper. No, no, for it is very ugly.
But very useful.
No, no, I should compare you to gold, which is the most valuable of all.
Come, come, let's not play. You corrupt me, Electra. You demoralize me.
Let me amuse myself with the qualities of this pretty metal which is like me. I am firm, unbendable. Well, you may say so to Evarista and Urbano, for in the sermon that they will give me today, they will tell me 40 times over that I am very fragile. Fragile, boy!
They don't know what they say.
Of course not. How should they know?
Be careful, Electra, with your talking. Don't make a mistake in the weight.
I make a mistake? How stupid. I am very careful, more so than you think.
Of course, I see you are.
Turns to one of the cases, looking for a crucible.
Well, your aunt will be really angry, and it will take a lot of work to convince her of your innocence.
God, who sees the heart, knows that there is no harm in this. Why shouldn't they let me stay here all day and take care of you and help you?
Maximo coming back with a crucible.
Because you are a young lady, and young ladies cannot remain alone in a man's house, however honorable and respectable he may be.
Well, we are very happy, we poor young ladies.
The work finished, she gives him the portions of the metal in porcelain pans.
Here it is.
Maximo takes the pans.
How fine! What skill! What clean hands! What steadiness, girl, and what care not to mix up the work! You are very careful.
And especially satisfied. When one is happy, everything is well done.
That's true, very true.
Pours the two metals into the crucible.
That is a crucible.
Yes, to fuse the two metals.
We are being fused. We are. We are struggling in the midst of fire and...
Hums the sonata.
Do me the favor to call Mariano.
Electra, going to the door at the left.
Mariano!
Have Hill come too.
Hill! Quickly! The master calls you.
Hurrying them.
Come on!
Scene 2. Electra, Maximo, Mariano, Hill, the first dressed as a workman in a blouse, the second in ordinary dress with sleeve protectors and a pen behind his ear. Hill, showing a calculation.
This is the value obtained.
Maximo reads rapidly the sum.
0, 158, 0, 73. It is wrong.
Sure of what he is saying, with severity.
It is not possible that for a cable diameter of less than 4 millimeters we should obtain a greater circuit, according to your calculation. The true distance is less than 200 kilometers.
Why, I don't know. Sir, I...
Confused.
It is bad. Doubtless your attention was distracted.
You don't pay proper attention. Careful attention.
While you are making the calculations, you are not paying attention to what you are doing.
Electra scolding him.
And talking about bullfights, theatres, and 1,000 foolish things. That's the way it comes.
I will rectify the work.
And especially much patience, using all your senses. That's the only way we shall make progress.
I am going.
Quickly, don't be careless.
Exit Hill. Maximo to Mariano, giving him the mixed metals.
Here you are.
For fusing.
Have you prepared the furnaces?
Yes, sir.
Put them in at once, and when they are at the point of fusing, tell me. With this alloy, we shall make a new test of conductibility. I hope to reach 200 kilometers with very little loss.
Shall we make the test this afternoon?
Maximo, troubled by a fixed idea.
Yes. I shall not give up this problem.
To Electra?
It is my fixed idea, which will not let me rest.
I have a fixed idea, too, and for that I live. On with it.
Maximo, to Electra.
On with it.
To Mariano.
Always forward.
Have you further orders?
That you hurry the fusion.
That you hurry the fusion, Mariano. Let the metals be well fused.
Both together, mademoiselle.
Exit Mariano.
Both together.
Maximo, as if preparing another operation.
Now, my gracious pupil.
Pardon me, sir magician. I must see if the children are awake.
That's true. How long is it since they ate?
3/4 of an hour. They ought to sleep a 1/2 hour more. Is that all right?
Yes, anything you arrange is all right.
Be careful what you are saying.
I am.
That everything I arrange is all right.
Maximo, looking at her affectionately.
Everything. Everything.
May it be so. Well, I'm going, and I'll be back in a hurry.
With great agility, singing, exit by the door on the right towards the interior of the house. As she leaves, the workman enters at the rear. Scene 3. Maximo, the workman.
What is it?
Sir, today that gentleman came again, the Marquis of Ronda.
And why didn't he come in?
He asked if he could see you. I told him that you had a visitor. And he, like one of the family, without malice, said, I know, Miss Electra. I think I'll not go in now. And he left.
Maximo, quickly.
I am sorry. Why didn't you announce him? How silly.
He said he would come back.
Well, if he comes back, let him come in, even if Miss Electra is here, and especially if she is here.
All right, sir.
Exit at rear. Scene 4. Maximo, Electra. Electra coming back.
They are sleeping like 2 little angels. I'll leave them there 1/2 hour more to rest their tired little bodies.
We ought to look after our own little bodies, or big bodies. Shall we eat?
Whenever you like. I have everything ready.
Turns to the sideboard, where there is a dinner service, plates, tablecloth, napkins, and a food dish.
I like that. Everything prompt. That's the way one always reaches one's goal.
Electra spreading the tablecloth.
In that way. But with all my care, I shall never get anywhere, alas.
Let me help you set the table.
Electra gives him the dishes, plates, the wine, and bread.
Yes, you will.
Do you think so?
I am as certain as I am, that I am as hungry as 50 horses.
I am glad. Now you mustn't fail to like the dinner that these poor hands have prepared.
Bring it, and we shall see.
Right away.
Exit to the interior of the house. Scene 5. Maximo Hill.
Strange. Every word, every action, every movement of this precious little woman, in the freedom she enjoys, are just so many more flashes thrown out by her uneasy soul, nobly ambitious, anxious to show itself great in affection and superior in virtue.
With ardor.
Blessed be she who brings joy and light to this hiding place of science, sad and dark, and with her charms makes of this barrenness a paradise. Blessed be she who has come to take from his abstraction this Faust, grown old at 35, and to say to him, one does not live by truths alone.
Hill, who has entered a short time before, interrupts him, approaching without being seen. Hill, satisfied, showing his calculations.
Here it is. I think I have obtained the exact figure.
Maximo takes the paper and looks at it vaguely, without attention.
Exactness? But do you think that one lives only by truths? Saturated with them, the soul longs for dreams, runs after them without knowing whether it goes from the correct to the incorrect, or from error to reality.
Reads mechanically.
0, 318.73. Considering it well, Hill, our mistakes in calculation are pardonable.
Yes, sir. One gets distracted easily, thinking of...
Of vague things, undetermined, pleasant, and the numbers escape, vanish in the air.
And anyone may catch them. Absent-minded, I confused the figure of the potential with that of the resistance, but now I have corrected it. Tell me if it is right.
Maximo reads...
0, 318.73.
With a sudden transition to an expansive pleasure.
And if it were not, Hill, if to brighten your mind with sweet ideas, with roseate images, poetic ones, you should have made a mistake, what would it matter? Our mistress, our tyrant, exactness, would pardon it.
Ah, sir, she does not pardon. She's very severe. She wears us out, enslaves us, gives us no chance to breathe.
Today, no. Today she is indulgent. The mistress, ordinarily so sullen, today smiles at us with a merry face. You see this sum?
Hill, saying it from memory, well satisfied.
0318.73.
Well, I say that the greatest poets of the world, Homer and Virgil, Dante, Lope, Calderon, never wrote a strophe as inspired and poetic as this is for me. These poor numbers. It is true that the harmony, the poetic enchantment, is not in them. It is in... Go on now. You may go to lunch. Leave me. Leave us.
Pushes him out.
I don't know myself. I also am confused. I am very bright with this loss of my calmness. It is she who...
From a convenient place on the stage, he looks towards the interior.
There is the imagination, there is the ideal, there the divine doll among the poets.
Returns to the front of the stage.
O Electra, you, playful and smiling, how full of life and hope and science, how inert, how solitary, how empty.
Scene 6. Maximo, Electra. Electra entering with a smoking casserole.
Here is the best thing.
Let's see what you have made. Rice with giblets. It looks superb.
Sits down.
You can praise it in advance, for it is very good. You will see.
Sits down.
There has come into my house a little angel of a cook.
Call me what you wish, Maximo, but don't call me an angel.
An angel of the kitchen.
Both laugh.
Not that either.
Passing him a plate.
Shall I serve you?
Not so much.
You see, there is nothing else. I thought that in eating, one good thing is better than a lot of mediocre ones.
They begin to eat.
You have struck it. Do you know what I am laughing about? What if Evarista should come now and find us eating so alone?
And if she knew that I cooked the meal?
Girl, do you know that this rice is very good, very well cooked?
In Hende, a Valencian lady was my teacher. She gave me a real course in rice. I know how to cook it at least 7 ways, all delicious.
Why, little one, you are a world to be discovered.
And who is my Columbus?
There is no Columbus. I say you are a world that discovers itself.
Electra laughing.
Well, because I am such a little world that thinks itself worthy of being discovered, poor me, they will decide to make a nun out of me in order to keep me from the dangers which threaten innocence.
Maximo, after trying the wine, looks at the label.
Well, you haven't brought a bad wine.
In your magnificent cellar, which is like a library of rich wine, I have selected the best Bordeaux and an extra fine sherry.
Very good. The librarian is not stupid.
Why, yes, I know already what is awaiting me. The solitude of a convent.
I fear so. You cannot escape from it.
Electra frightened.
What?
Maximo correcting himself.
I mean, yes, you shall escape. I shall save you.
You have promised to protect me.
Yes, yes, nothing more was necessary.
Electra, with great interest.
And what do you propose to do? Tell me.
You will see. The affair is serious.
Talk with my aunt. And what else?
Well, I shall talk with your aunt.
And what will you say to her?
I shall talk with your uncle.
Electra, impatiently.
Good. Let us suppose that you have talked with all the aunts and uncles in the world. After that—
What does the course of procedure matter to you? Be sure that I shall take you under my protection, and once that you are put in an honorable and safe place, I shall proceed to the selection of a lover. Of this I wish to talk to you now.
Are you going to scold me?
No. They have told me already that you are deceiving yourself with the game of living dolls, or lovers, they call themselves.
I have sought in them a medicine for my weariness, and with every dose I get more bored.
None of them has awakened in you a feeling, other than jests?
Not one.
They have all declared themselves in writing?
Some, in the language of the eyes, which I do not always know how to interpret, so I do not count them.
Yes, you should count all in the catalogue, those who show their affection in their eyes as well as those who use the pen. And here we are facing the serious condition which calls for my opinion and my counsel. Electra, you ought to marry, and soon.
Electra, lowering her eyes bashfully.
Soon? Heavens, what is the hurry?
The sooner the better. You need at your side a man, a husband. You have a heart, temperament, matrimonial instincts, and virtues. Well, from the crowd of your suitors, it will be necessary for me to select one, the best, one who, on account of his qualities, will be worthy of you. And the culmination of happiness will be that my choice coincides with your preference, for we should make no progress in the matter, be sure of that, if I did not succeed in arranging for you a love match.
Electra, with spontaneousness.
Oh, yes, indeed.
A tranquil life, exemplary, fruitful, with a happy home.
Oh, what loveliness! But do I merit all this?
I believe that you do. It will soon be seen.
They finish eating their eyes.
Do you wish more?
No, thank you. I have eaten very well.
Electra, putting the fruit dish on the table.
For dessert I have nothing but fruit. I know that you like that very much.
Maximo, selecting a beautiful apple.
Yes, because this is the truth. In this the hand of man has no part, except to pick it.
It is the work of God, beautiful, splendid, with no artificiality.
God makes these wonderful things in order that man may pick them and eat them. But not all have the happiness or the good fortune to pass under the tree.
Pears and apple.
Yes, they pass under it. But some go absorbed, looking at the ground, so that they do not see the beautiful fruit which says to them, "Pick me, enjoy me," and they would only need to get away from their thoughts for one moment and raise their eyes.
Maximo, looking at her.
Raise their eyes. I am looking now.
Scene 7. Electra, Maximo, Mariano at the left.
Sir.
What is it?
It is fiery red.
Ah, the fusion.
When it comes to a white heat, let me know.
Mariano, about to go.
All right.
Listen, have the Bunsen battery arranged for us in the factory. Tell them that before lighting up I need the large dynamo for a test.
Very well.
Exit at the back. Scene 8. Electra, Maximo. Afterwards, the workman. Electra, sadly.
Soon you will have to be busy with the fusion, and I...
You, naturally, will go back home.
Electra, sighing.
Oh, alas, I don't like to think of the fuss there will be when I go in.
Listen, keep still and wait.
Wait, wait, always wait.
They finish eating. Electra rises and clears off the dishes.
Oh, if you do not look after this poor orphan, I fear that she is going to be very unhappy. It is too bad. Evarista and Pantejo insist that I must be an angel, and I... God does not call me for the angelical path.
Maximo, who has reason and seems disposed to continue his work...
Do not fear. Trust in me. I shall claim you as your protector, as your teacher.
Electra, approaching him with a supplicating manner...
But do not delay. For the health of your children, Maximo, do not delay. Listen to what I think. Why don't you take me like one of your children, and keep me like them, and with them?
Maximo, with seriousness, very affectionately.
Do you know, that is an excellent idea. We must think it over. Let me think about it.
Workman at the back.
The Marquis of Ronda.
Electra, frightened.
Oh, I must go.
No, daughter, he is our friend, our best friend. You will see.
To the workman.
Let him come in.
Exit workman.
He will think, perhaps.
He will think nothing bad. Have you made coffee?
I will go and strain it now. The finest coffee. I know how to make it delicious.
Bring it in. Let us invite the Marquis.
All right, all right. Since you order it, I'm going for the coffee.
Exit gaily with light step. Scene 9. Maximo, the Marquis, Electra. At the end of the scene, Mariano.
Come in, Marquis.
My dear, illustrious friend.
Disconsolately looking around.
And Electra?
In the kitchen.
In the kitchen?
She will be back in a moment. We have eaten, and now we shall take coffee.
You have eaten?
Looking at the table.
Some delicious rice prepared by her.
Thank God for that.
Very disconsolately.
But man, not invite me? Well, I shall not pardon you.
Why, it was all so unexpected. Why didn't you come in before, when you were in the shop?
That's true. It is my fault.
We shall take coffee. And excuse, my dear Marquis, having it in this poor student's room.
I have already told you. I can never understand how you, a man of means, having upstairs such fine rooms...
It is very simple. Science and the habit of study shut me up in this den. I have put my children in the rooms downstairs in order to have them near me, and here I live like a hermit.
Forgetting that you are very rich.
My opulence is simplicity, my luxury, solitude, my repose, work, and so I have to live as long as I am alone.
The solitude approaches its end. It must be decided. In short, I come, my dear friend, to forewarn you.
Enters Electra with the coffee.
Oh, the charming divine housekeeper!
Electra advances carefully with a tray in which she has the service, fearing that some piece may fall.
Heavens, Marquis, don't scold me.
I scold you?
Nor make me laugh. I am afraid of breaking something. Be careful.
The Marquis takes the tray.
I am here to prevent any catastrophe.
Puts all on the table.
I have nothing to scold you for, my daughter. Anywhere else this liberty would frighten me. In the dwelling of most honorable industry, of the most exquisite chivalry, it causes me no fear.
Thanks, Sir Marquis.
Serves them the coffee.
The lady and gentleman across the way will not appreciate it so highly. The news of what is happening here has reached the asylum of Santa Clara, foundation of Maria Requesens. Confusion and alarm of the Garcia Yosts. The whole conclave is gathered there.
God have mercy on me.
Be calm, my daughter.
Never mind, leave it to us.
In me, for all the contingencies that this prank may involve, you have an unconditional friend, a valiant defender.
Electra affectionately.
Oh, Marquis, how good you are.
How kind.
And what have you to say of my coffee?
That it is fit for Jupiter, the father of the gods. In Olympus they never served better. Blessed be the hands that made it. God grant to my old age the consolation of repeating these tete-a-tetes with the same two persons.
Very affectionately, taking the hands of each.
With the two friends who now listen to me, wait upon me, and welcome me.
Oh, what a beautiful wish!
I am going to allow myself to use, with you, my dear Maximo, a sign of confidence. Do not take it badly. My gray hairs warrant me.
I can guess it, Marquis.
From this moment, this reform shall be established, a social one. I am going to speak to you with familiarity.
I shall consider it a great honor.
And why not to me?
Marquis to Maximo.
What do you think? To her, too?
Yes, yes. Under my responsibility.
Electra applauding.
Bravo, bravo!
Marquis very satisfied.
Well, my friends, I return your confidence by informing you that the conclave is preparing against you resolutions of unheard-of severity.
Dear me, what for?
The Garcia Yost, very holy and very pious, God keep them, have started to navigate through the infinite, and, wishing to rise very high, have thrown overboard the ballast which is worldly logic.
Maximo makes signs of assent.
I don't understand.
This ballast, this lead, worldly logic, human logic, we shall pick it up.
Maximo laughing.
Very good. Very good.
Electra applauding without understanding it.
Ballast, lead, picked up. Human logic, very good.
Masters of this force, this sacred logic, it is urgent that we prepare to frustrate the plans of the enemy. Our first determination...
To Electra?
That you return home. Don't be frightened. You will not go alone.
Oh, I breathe more freely.
There will go with you the two professors of worldly logic who are here.
Electra, pleased.
Thank heaven, what happiness! I between the two, escorted by a pair of the civil guards.
Maximo to the Marquis.
Don't you think we should go by day in order to see with what arrogance the criminals defy the broad daylight?
Oh, no. I think we should go after dark in order that it may be seen that our honesty does not fear the dark.
Excellent idea. By night.
By night.
Mariano appearing at the left-hand door.
Sir, it is at a white heat.
Electra with childish joy.
The fusion!
She says this with unconscious joy. Maximo to Mariano.
I can't go now. Tell me when it reaches a molten brightness.
Exit Mariano. Marquis with solemnity taking a glass.
Permit me, my dear friends, to drink to the happy union, to the happy marriage of these two metals.
Maximo with enthusiasm raising the glass.
I drink to our first metallurgist, the noble Marquis of Ronda.
Electra with emotion following the toast.
To the great and affectionate friend.
Pantoja appears at the right, coming from the garden. He remains in the door contemplating with a cold stupor the scene. Scene 10. Maximo, Electra, the Marquis, Pantoja.
The enemy!
Electra frightened.
Don Salvador, the Lord help me.
Come in, Sir Pantoja.
Pantoja advances silently, slowly.
To what do I owe the honor?
Anticipating my good friends, Urbano and Evarista, who will be back home soon, I am here to fulfill my duty and theirs.
Their duty? Yours?
You come to surprise us with the air of a spy.
Doubtless you see in us hardened criminals.
I see nothing. I wish to see only Electra, for whom I have come. Electra, who ought not to be here, and who will withdraw now with me, and with me will weep her error.
Takes the hand of Electra, who is as if lifeless, motionless through fear.
Come.
Pardon me.
Serene and serious, he approaches Pantoja.
With all respect due to you, Sir Pantoja, I beg that you release her hand. Before taking it, you should speak with me, who am the master of this house, and the one responsible for all that occurs in it, for all that you see, for that which you do not wish to see.
Pantoja, after a short hesitation, releases the hand of Electra.
Very well. For the moment I release the hand of the poor creature, led astray, or brought here by deception, and I shall speak to you, to whom I wish to say but a few words. I come for Electra. Give me that which is not yours, that which can never be yours.
Electra is free. I have not brought her here against her will, nor shall you take her away against her will.
You, who do not even indicate on what you base your authority?
I do not need to tell you the basis of my authority. Why should I take that trouble when I am sure that the gracious, but blind, child cannot deny the obedience that I ask of her? Electra, my dear daughter, is not a word or a look of mine sufficient to separate you from these men and take you to the arms of one who has summed up in you the purest love, who neither lives nor wishes to live except for you?
Stiff and looking at the floor, Electra remains silent.
No, it is not enough, this word of yours.
She does not seem convinced, my dear sir.
Allow me to question her. Electra, my dear child, answer. Does your heart and your conscience tell you that among all the men that you know, those whom you see here and those who are not present, that you owe the obedience of love to this man alone?
Ask your heart, daughter. Ask your conscience.
And if he orders you to follow him and we wish you to remain here, which would you do of your own free will?
Electra, after a painful struggle.
Stay here.
You see?
She is fascinated. She is not mistress of herself.
You will not insist.
You will declare yourself conquered.
Pantoja, with cold tenacity.
I do not consider myself conquered. Reason is always victorious, and I should deem myself unworthy of possessing that which God has given me and that I keep here, if I did not place it continually above all errors and excesses. No, I shall not yield. Maximo, the metals which burn in your furnaces are less firm than I. Your powerful machines are but structures of reed if you compare them with my will. Electra belongs to me. It is sufficient that I say so.
Electra aside.
What a terror I feel.
If you wish to be sure of the power of your will, try it against me.
I do not need to try it against you nor anyone, but to do that which I ought.
Duty, that is my strength.
A duty with movable grounds and accidental ends. My duty is moved by a conscience as strong and firm as the axis of the universe, and my ends are so high that you cannot see them, nor will you ever be able to see them.
Rise as high as you like. I shall go to the very highest point to tell you that I do not fear you, nor does Electra either.
The man is stubborn.
In order that you may talk about firm metals.
Electra will go home with us.
With me, and this will be enough for her aunt and uncle to pardon her caprice.
They will not pardon her, nor will they receive her better, going with you, because they cannot go against their feelings, against their firmest convictions.
With ecstasy.
I am in the world in order that Electra may not be lost, and she shall not be lost. This is the wish of the divine will, of which mine is the reflection, which seems to you capricious brutality because you do not understand the great undertakings of the spirit. Poor blind ones, poor fools.
Electra, in consternation.
Don Salvador, by the Virgin, don't get angry. I am not bad. Maximo is good. You know it. My aunt and uncle know it. You say that I ought not to be here. All right, I shall go back home. Maximo and the Marquis will go with me, and my aunt and uncle will pardon me.
To Maximo and the Marquis.
Isn't it true that they will pardon me?
To Pantoja.
Why do you wish Maximo ill, who has never done you any harm? Isn't that so? What reason is there in this ill will?
It is not ill will. It is hatred, secret and inextinguishable.
Hate you? No. My creed forbids hate. It is certain that between us, because of your insane ideas, there is a certain incompatibility. Moreover, your father, Lazarus Yuste, and I, alas, we had profound differences of which it is better not to speak now. But I do not hate you, Maximo. Rather do I esteem you.
Combining his austere tone with another, more suave and conciliatory.
Leaving aside the severity with which I spoke to you in the beginning, and forcing somewhat my character, I beg you that you permit Electra to go with me.
Maximo, inflexible.
I cannot grant your request.
Pantoja, becoming more violent.
For the second time, Maximo, forgetting all resentment, almost desiring your friendship, I beg you, let her go.
Impossible.
Pantoja, swallowing his humiliation.
All right. You have refused me the second time. I have only two cheeks. If I had three on which to receive your blows, I should beg you again.
With gravity and stiffness, with no inflection of tenderness.
Adieu, Electra. Maximo, Marquis. Adieu.
Electra, in a low voice to Maximo.
For heaven's sake, Maximo, compromise a little.
Maximo, positively.
No.
Didn't you say that you and the Marquis would take me? Let us all go together.
This is heard by Pantoja as he moves slowly towards the door. Stops. Maximo, with energy.
No, he must go first. When it suits us and without the protection of anyone, he shall go.
Pantoja, coldly, now in the door.
And for what do you go? To make the situation of the poor girl worse?
I am going. For what am I going?
May I not know it?
It is unnecessary.
I have not tried to get you to reveal to me your intentions. And why should I, if I know them?
Takes some steps towards the center of the stage, fixing his gaze on Maximo.
I do not trust the expression of your eyes. I penetrate into the profoundest depths of your mind. There I see what you are thinking. I did not question you to know your intention, for I know it already, but not from hearing the fine promises you have made. In you there is no truth. In you there is no good. No, no, no.
Goes out slowly, repeating the last words.
No, no, no.
Scene 11. Electra, Maximo, the Marquis, Mariano. Electra frightened.
He has gone. Will he come back?
What a man!
It begins to grow dark.
Rather than a man, he is a mountain that wishes to fall upon us and crush us.
But he will not fall. It is an imaginary and inoffensive mountain.
Electra in consternation, seeking refuge by the side of Maximo.
Protect me, Maximo. Take away from me this fear.
Have no fear. Come to me.
Takes her by the hands.
It is growing dark. We ought to go now.
Let's go.
Incredulous and fearful.
But really, are you going with me?
Together in this, as we shall be in all our lives.
With you always.
The darkness increases. Mariano at the door on the left.
Sir, it is molten white.
Marquis to Mariano.
The fusion is finished. Put out the furnaces.
Maximo with great effusion, kissing her hands.
Luminous soul, great heart, with you always. I am going to tell your aunt and uncle that I claim you, that you will be my companion and the mother of my children.
Electra, oppressed as if the joy overcomes her.
Do not deceive me. Shall I live with your children? Shall I be with them the oldest one? Shall I be your wife?
Maximo, in a strong voice.
Yes, yes.
The back room being lighted, the whole stage is brilliant.
Let us go. It is already night.
It is day. An eternal day for me.
Maximo puts his arm around her and they go out. The Marquis follows them. End of Act 3. Act 4 of Electra by Benito Pérez Galdós, translated by Charles Alfred Shirell. This is the LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Act 4. Garden of the House of García Yuste. At the right, entrance to the house with a stairway of a few steps. At the left, corresponding to the entrance, a massive grotto-like architecture, decorated with bas-reliefs. At its foot, a stone bench in an angle, of elegant appearance. Urns of exotic plants in pots decorate this terrace, whose floor is mosaic, between the building and the sanded floor of the garden. Further back and in the rear, the garden, with great trees and clusters of flowers. In the center are three curved walks. That on the left leads to the street. Iron chairs. It is day. Scene 1. Electra, Patras, with a basket of flowers she has just gathered. Electra, taking from her pocket a letter.
Leave the flowers here and take the letter.
Patras leaves the flowers.
Three have gone today.
Electra, taking the small flowers and making of them three bouquets.
There is not enough time for Maximo and me to say the world of things we wish.
Blessed be God, who in one night has brought the young lady such happiness.
Last night he asked my hand. Today my aunt and uncle will decide the date of the wedding.
And meanwhile letters go and come.
In these hours of feverish impatience, Maximo and I cannot deprive ourselves of written communications. In my letter of 8:15 I told him some very serious things. In that of 9:25, I told him not to neglect to give little Lola the spoonful of syrup every 2 hours, and in this which you are taking, I am telling him that my aunt is at Mass, and that she has not come back yet. One has to talk, naturally.
Of course. The mistress will not be back before 11.
And at 11 I shall go with my uncle.
Tying up the 3 bouquets.
Here they are. This for him, and these for the children. One for each, so they will not quarrel.
Starting to arrange a large bouquet.
Now a bouquet for the Virgin de los Dolores. Go and come back quickly to help me. Wait for a reply, for even if it is only 2 words, it will fill me with joy.
I shall go quickly.
Goes out at the rear. Electra, selecting the most beautiful flowers for the bouquet.
Today, Virgin mine, my offering will be larger than usual. It ought to be so large that there would not be a flower left in my uncle's garden. I should like today to lay before your image all the pretty things that there are in nature, the roses, the stars, the hearts that know how to love. O Holy Virgin, our counsel and hope, do not abandon me. Grant me the blessings I asked of you, and you promised me last night, speaking to me with the expression of your divine eyes, when with my tears I told you my anxiety, my gratitude.
Patras, hurrying through the garden.
I do not bring a letter, but a message that is worth more.
What? Out with it.
Right away. As soon as some gentlemen go who are just leaving. Wait for him here, and you can talk a while. He has to go to a telephonic conference.
Electra, looking towards the back of the stage.
Will he come?
Hears steps.
It seems...
He is coming now.
Electra, giving her the bouquet.
Here, for the Virgin.
All right.
Electra, stopping her.
But don't give it to the Virgin of the Oratory. Be careful, Patros. Not to the one in the oratory, but to mine, that I have at the head of my bed. Please don't make a mistake.
Oh, no. I know.
Enters hurriedly into the house. Scene 2. Electra, Maximo, afterwards the Marquis. Maximo, at a distance, opening slightly his arms.
My girl!
Electra, the same.
My master!
Are we ashamed and don't know what to say?
Very. You begin.
No, you. In order that you may get rid of your bashfulness, tell me a big story, that you do not love me.
You tell me first a great truth.
That I adore you.
They approach each other.
False one, traitor. Take this rose that I picked for you. It is very small and modest, so I should always like to be your little one.
Puts it in his buttonhole.
Big heart, great intelligence.
Increase the heart and discount the intelligence.
I shall discount nothing.
Do you know, I should like to be very rude and very rough, in order to come to you in the greatest ignorance, so that you might teach me my first ideas. I should like to have nothing that does not come from you.
Beautiful ideas and noble sentiments you have in abundance. God has endowed you generously, heaping on you excellences, and now put you in my hands, that this very slow workman may model you, finish you, polish you.
You are going to show to advantage, master. I tell you that you will.
I shall make a good, sensible, loving woman. Is that showing off?
Looks at his watch.
Don't stay on my account. We must consider first our obligations. Will you be very late?
I think not. I shall be here when Evarista returns from Mass.
And has our Marquis come as he promised?
I left him in the house writing a letter to his notary. Incomparable friend. Oh, do you know? Last night, when we went back to the house, I told him the novel of your paternity. The novel in 2 chapters. The man was indignant. But by it we gain, for we have his complete devotion, and with all the more heart and affection he defends us.
Electra, surprised.
But do we still need defense?
In the essential things, no, of course not. But how can we be sure that the rivals of our friend will not trouble us with difficulties, with obstacles of a secondary nature?
Electra, becoming tranquil.
We should laugh at them.
But even while laughing, we should be prepared.
Marquis, quickly from the rear.
Here yet?
Marquis, into your hands I commend my soul.
Marquis, smiling affectionately.
You will be late.
I am going now. I shall see you very soon.
Electra, seeing him start.
Run. Come back quickly.
Scene 3. Electra, the Marquis.
Good for the scientific gallant. And what an admirable find for you! Your youthful love needs the love of a widower. Your wild imagination, a cold reason. At the sight of this man, my girl will become a great woman.
I shall be that which he wishes to make me.
With great curiosity.
Tell me, Marquis, did you know the poor wife of Maximo? My curiosity will not surprise you. It is very natural that I should want to know the former life of the man I love.
I didn't know her. I saw her with Maximo once or twice. She was a Basque, rough and ordinary, not very intelligent, but a good wife. But that marriage could not have been a model of happiness.
Did you know Maximo's parents?
I never saw his mother. She was French, a lady of great merit. My wife was a friend of hers. I knew Lazarus Yost, but not intimately, in Spain and in France about the year 68. A man very intelligent and fortunate in minds, and with no little luck, they say, too, in love affairs. He was a man who caused talk.
In this he was not like his son, who is correctness itself.
You may well say that you have drawn the prize of a husband, the most worthy and the finest, head of a giant, heart of a child. And having all that, he is the possessor of a good fortune, that which his father left him, and the recent inheritance from his French uncle. What more could you wish? I should answer, child, there is nothing more.
Electra, sighing deeply.
Oh, alas! And now tell me, Marquis, can I be tranquil?
Absolutely.
And have I nothing to fear from the two persons who— You already know that they think they have an authority.
They may bother you some, perhaps, but we shall teach them their place.
And Cuesta?
He is the least to be feared. I have talked with him today, and I trust he will end by helping us.
And Pontejo?
He will grumble. He will give us a few headaches, if we let him. He will blow the biblical trumpet to frighten us, but don't pay any attention to him.
Really?
He can do nothing, absolutely nothing.
And if I find him here, I should not be frightened.
Why should you be frightened by the monotonous buzzing of a gadfly that goes and comes, circles and turns?
Oh, what a satisfaction to my poor mind!
With affectionate enthusiasm.
Marquis of Ronda, may God bless you.
Marquis, very affectionately.
My poor girl, God will be with you.
Scene 4. The same. Don Urbano, who comes from the house with hat on.
Marquis, God be with you.
May I speak with you, my dear Urbano?
Would it be just as well after Mass?
To Electra.
But, child, you are so quiet. The bells are ringing already.
I have only to put on my hat. A half minute, uncle.
Enters hurriedly into the house.
Let us settle the day of the wedding, and draw up the act of consent.
It would be better to talk about that with Evarista.
But, my friend, the time has come for you to put up a bold front to certain interferences that annul the authority of the head of the family.
My dear Marquis, ask me to change completely, to overturn the planetary system, to take the stars from the heavens, but do not ask me to oppose the opinions of my wife.
Man, don't show such submissiveness. I insist that I should discuss this matter with you, and not with Evarista.
Come with us to Mass, and we will talk about it.
All right, I will go.
Scene 5. The same. Electra, Evarista, Pantoja. Electra, with hat, gloves, and prayer book.
Here I am.
Come on, the Marquis is going with us.
Evarista, entering at the left in the rear, followed by Pantoja.
Go on, quickly.
Quickly, if you want to get in there on time.
Will you come back, Marquis?
Oh, certainly, without fail.
Goodbye.
Electra, the Marquis, and Don Urbano exit at rear. Scene 6. Evarista, Pantoja, who in an attitude of great fatigue, throws himself on the bench in the left foreground.
Shall we go into the house?
No, let me get my breath. In the church I almost stifled. The heat, the crowd.
I will have them bring you some refreshment. Balbina!
No, I thank you.
A cup of lime tea?
No, thanks.
Enters Balbina. Her mistress gives her her mantilla, which she has just taken off, and her prayer book, and sends her away.
There is no reason, my friend, for such dejection.
It is not my pride, as they say, that is wounded. It is something more delicate and deeper. There is denied me the consolation, the glory of guiding this poor girl and leading her along the paths of righteousness, and it afflicts me more that you, so in sympathy with my ideas, you, in whom I saw a faithful friend and a fervent ally, abandon me at the critical hour.
Pardon me, Don Salvador, I do not abandon you. We were agreed to keep her. I do not say shut her up, this crazy girl, in San Jose de la Penitencia, watching over her discipline and purification. But there has arisen unexpectedly the inconceivable caprice of Maximo, and I cannot in any way refuse my consent. It would be a piece of folly, and it does not concern me. But of Maximo, as a man of good conduct, what have you to say?
Nothing.
Correcting himself.
Oh, yes, I might say something. But for the moment I shall say only that Electra is not prepared for matrimony, nor in a state to choose properly. I do not oppose absolutely her marriage, provided it be with a man whose ideas cannot hurt her, but I will come to this later. The first thing is that this tender creature should enter the convent where we shall test her. We shall try with extreme tact her character, her tastes, her affections, and in view of what we shall determine, it can be decided...
With haughtiness.
What have you to say?
Evarista, intimidated.
That for this plan, very fine I admit, I cannot offer you my cooperation.
Pantoja, with arrogance, walking up and down.
So according to you, Doña Evarista, if the girl wishes to be lost, let her be lost. If she insists on her own damnation, let her be damned quickly.
Evarista, with greater timidity, as if under a spell.
Her ruin! And how can I help it? Is it in my hands?
Pantoja, with energy.
It is.
Oh, no, I lack the courage to interfere. And with what right? Impossible, Don Salvador, impossible.
Pantoja, asserting more and more his authority.
You must know, my friend, that the act of separating Electra from a world in which innumerable malignant beasts surround her and threaten her is not despotism. It is love in the purest expression of maternal affection, which often hurts in order to heal. Do you doubt that the great aim of my life today is the welfare of the poor girl?
Evarista, more and more intimidated.
I do not doubt it. I cannot doubt it.
Pantoja, with effusion and eloquence.
I love Electra with a love so intense that all the subtleties of human speech would not suffice to declare it. When my eyes saw her, the voice of blood cried out with me, saying that this creature belonged to me. I wish, and I ought to have her under my sacred and paternal rule, that she may love me as the angels love, that she should be my image in conduct, my reflection in ideas, that she should recognize her duty to suffer for those who gave her life, and purifying should help us who were wicked to obtain pardon. For God's sake, do you not understand me?
Evarista, overcome.
Yes, and how I admire your powerful intellect.
I prefer less admiration and more efficiency in my favor.
I cannot.
Sits down weeping and depressed.
Naturally, Electra cannot inspire in you the great interest that she does in me.
Using suave means of persuasion.
If, at first, the separation of the girl from worldly pleasures would cause her sorrow, it would soon bring her peace and happy calm. I shall endow her amply. All that I possess will be hers for the splendor of her holy house. Electra will be named Mother Superior, and under my authority will govern the congregation.
With deep emotion.
How happy she will be, and I so happy.
Remains as in a state of exaltation.
I understand, indeed, that by not acceding to what you ask me, I deprive this creature of reaching the highest state of human perfection. You well know my sentiments, with what pleasure I would exchange the wealth in which I live for the glory of directing obscurely a religious house with much work and humility. I always admire you for your protection of La Penitencia. I admire you more when I know that you redoubled your aid when my poor Eleutheria, transfixed with sorrow like a new Magdalene, was seeking in this institution peace and pardon. In your act I saw the most pure spirituality.
Yes, when your unhappy cousin entered that house, my protection was not only more positive, but more spiritual. I never saw Eleutheria after she was converted, since she never allowed herself to be seen by anyone, not even by me. But I went daily to the church and conversed in spirit with the penitent, considering her regenerated, as indeed she was. The unhappy one died at the age of 45. I asked permission to bury her in the interior of the edifice, and since then I have protected more the congregation. I have made it entirely mine, because in it rested the remains of her whom I loved.
And now he whom we may call the founder visits the holy house every day without missing one, and the humble and poetic cemetery where the deceased sisters rest.
Pantoja, with vivacity.
Do you know about it?
I do. And walks around the flowered patio in the shade of the cypresses and oleanders.
That is true. And how did you know?
The founder walks and wanders about, praying for himself and for the poor sinner, imploring for her rest and his own.
Oh, yes. There will rest my poor bones, too.
With great vehemence.
I wish, moreover, that just as my spirit may not leave that house, in it may reside also, as long as there be need, the spirit of Electra. I shall not force her to the life of the cloister. But if, after trying it, she should find enjoyment in the beautiful life and should wish to remain in it, I should believe that God had granted to me the most ineffable of favors. Oh, what a beautiful end! What grandeur and what joy!
Evarista, with lively emotion.
Grandeur, indeed! Incomparable idealism!
Do you still doubt that my ends are high, that no insane passion moves me?
How should I doubt that?
Then if my plan seems to you a good one, why will you not help me?
Because I haven't the strength to do so.
Not even giving the assurance that the seclusion of the girl will have the nature of a trial?
Not even so. No, Don Salvador, do not count on me.
Struggling with her conscience.
I recognize the grandeur, the beauty of your ideas. I sympathize with them. I feel the echo of such ideas in my own heart. But I also owe something to the social life, and in the social and family life, what you wish is impossible.
Pantoja, hiding his vexation.
Very well. Patience.
Petulant and gloomy, he walks up and down. Evarista, after a pause.
What do you think? That I shall yield?
Pantoja, with naturalness and firmness.
No, madam.
Then how?
I don't know. An idea will come to me. I shall see.
Making a resolution.
Evarista, will you do me the favor to write a letter to the Mother Superior of La Penitencia?
Saying to her?
That she should come here at once with two sisters.
Why don't you write?
Because I must hurry elsewhere.
And it must be soon?
At once.
All right.
Turns to the house.
Send the letter without loss of time.
Evarista, looking towards the garden.
It seems to me they are coming.
Quickly, my friend.
I am going. God inspire us all.
Enters the house.
I shall be with you.
Aside.
I do not want them to see me.
Hides himself behind the bushes at the right, near to the staircase. Scene 7. Pantoja, hidden. Electra, Don Urbano, the Marquis, who returned from Mass. Patras, who comes out of the house. Electra, approaching, meets Patras at the foot of the staircase.
Has he come?
No, miss.
There is heard the distant singing of children playing in the garden.
I am dying of impatience.
Takes off her hat and gloves and gives them with a prayer book to Patros.
I shall wait there playing with the children. First I shall pick some flowers.
Don Urbano to Patros.
Your mistress?
In the house, sir.
Let us go there.
You first, Marquis.
They enter the house. After them, Patros. Electra, admiring the flowers she has picked.
How pretty, how graceful this clematis.
Pantoja comes out. She is frightened at seeing him. Scene 8. Electra, Pantoja.
My daughter, are you frightened at me?
Alas, yes. I cannot help it. And I ought not to be, no. Excuse me, Don Salvador. I am going to play with the children.
Wait a moment. Are you going to let the little ones communicate to you their joy?
No, sir. I am going to communicate mine to them, for I have an abundance of it.
The singing of the children dies away.
I know already the cause of your great joy. I know it already.
Well, if you know it, there is nothing more to say. Goodbye, Don Salvador.
Pantoja, detaining her.
Ungrateful one, grant me a moment.
Just a moment?
No more.
All right.
Sits down on the stone bench, puts the flowers to one side, and goes on picking them to decorate herself with them, fastening them in her hair.
I do not know why you keep up such a reserve with me, knowing how much your existence and your happiness interest me.
Electra, without looking at him, busy fastening the flowers.
Well, if my happiness interests you, rejoice with me. I am very happy.
Happy today? And tomorrow?
Tomorrow more so, and always more and more so.
True and constant happiness, the indestructible joy, exists only in eternal love, superior to human inquietudes and miseries.
Electra, having decorated her hair, puts flowers in her dress.
Are you playing again on the same key about my being an angel? I am very worldly, Don Salvador. God made me a woman, since he put me on earth and not in heaven.
There are angels on earth, too. They are angels who, in the midst of the disorders of the world, know how to live the life of the spirit.
Electra, displaying herself decorated with flowers, hears again, nearer, the singing of the children.
How is it? Do I seem an angel?
You always seem so. I wish you were.
This is the way I decorate myself to amuse the children. If you could just see how they laugh.
With a sudden, sad thought.
Do you know what I look like now? Well, a dead child. This is the way they decorate the dead children when they bury them.
In order to symbolize the ideal beauty of the heaven to which they have gone.
Electra, taking off the flowers.
No, no, I don't want to look like a dead child. I might imagine you were taking me to the tomb.
I don't want to bury you. I should like to surround you with light.
The song of the children dies away again and stops.
They put lights on the dead children, too.
I don't wish your death, but your life. Not an uneasy and vulgar life, but sweet, free, high, loving, with eternal and pure love.
Electra, confused.
And why do you wish all this for me?
Because I love you, with a love of a kind above all human loves. I shall make you understand better the greatness of this affection by telling you that to avoid for you a slight suffering, I would take upon myself the most horrible anguish you can imagine.
Electra, stupefied, without hearing well.
That is self-abnegation.
Consider how much I shall suffer, since I cannot keep from you a sorrow, a grief.
From me?
From you.
A sorrow?
A sorrow. Which afflicts me the more since I have been the cause of it.
Electra, rebelling, rises.
Sorrows! No, I do not wish them. Keep them for yourself. Bring me nothing but joys.
Pantoja, sympathetically.
Would that I could, but it cannot be.
Oh, now I am frightened.
With a sudden idea that calms her.
Ah, now I understand. Poor Don Salvador. You want to tell me something bad about Maximo, something you think bad from your standard, and that according to mine is not. Don't trouble. I shall not believe it.
Hurrying her speech without giving Pantoja time to reply.
Maximo is the best man in the world, the first, and I detest anyone who says a word to me contrary to this fact. I detest him.
For heaven's sake, let me speak. Don't be so hasty. My daughter, I do not speak evil of anyone, not even of those that hate me. Maximo is good, industrious, most intelligent. What more do you want?
Electra pleased.
That's it. That's it.
I will say more. I will say that you may love him, that it is your duty to love him.
Electra with great satisfaction.
Ah.
And to love him with all your heart.
Pause.
He is not to blame, no.
To blame?
Alarmed again.
Come, are you going to end by telling something naughty about him?
About him, no.
Well, about whom?
Remembering.
Ah, I know that the father of Maximo and you were terrible enemies. They have also told me that this gentleman, so honorable in business, was somewhat wild. You understand me? But this has nothing to do with me.
Most innocent creature, you don't know what you are saying.
I say that. That excellent man.
Lazarus Yuste. Yes. In naming him, I have to associate his memory with that of a person who no longer exists. Very dear to you.
Electra, understanding and not wishing to understand.
To me.
A person who no longer exists, very dear to you.
Pause. They look at each other. Electra, in terror, with scarcely audible voice.
My mother.
Pantoja makes an affirmative sign with his head.
My mother!
Astonished, desiring, but fearing the explanation.
The day of pardon has come. Let us pardon.
Electra, indignant.
My mother, my poor mother! They do not name her except to dishonor her.
Furious.
I should like to have them in my hand, to tear them to pieces, to destroy them, and not leave a single piece of them.
Oh, alas for me! I ought not, no, I ought not to have spoken to you of this. What would I give to have kept silent, to have hidden it from you all the days of my life? My affection commands me to speak.
Electra anxiously.
And I shall have to listen.
I have said that Lazarus Yuste.
Electra, covering her ears.
I don't want to hear it.
Your mother was then just about the age you are now, 18 years.
Electra, angry and rebelling.
I don't believe it. I don't believe anything. I don't believe.
She was a charming young woman.
Electra, rebelling more energetically.
Be still. I don't believe anything. I don't believe.
Pantoja, sorrowfully.
My dear daughter, turn your eyes to God.
Electra, upset.
I am dreaming. All that I see is a lie, illusion.
Looking here and there with frightened eyes.
Lies are these trees, this house, that sky. You do not exist. It is a monstrous nightmare.
Beating her head.
Wake up, unhappy woman, wake up.
Pantoja trying to calm her.
Electra, my dear child, innocent soul.
Electra with cries from her heart.
Mother, my mother, the truth, tell me the truth.
Out of her head, running about the stage.
Where are you, mother? I wish death or the truth. Mother, come to me. Mother, mother!
Runs quickly from the stage and is lost in the distant foliage. Soon there sounds again the singing of the children at play. Scene 9. Pantoja, Don Urbano, the Marquis. From the house quickly after them, Balbina and Patros.
What has happened?
We heard Electra crying out.
And she went running through the garden.
This way.
Alarmed, both rush out and disappear in the garden. Marquis looking through the bushes.
There she goes. She is running and keeps on crying. Oh, my dear child!
Rushes into the garden.
What is this?
I will explain it to you. Wait, let us arrange now.
What?
Pantoja, trying to arrange his ideas.
Let me think. It will be necessary to bring her to the house. Come.
Don Urbano, looking towards the garden.
Maximo is coming.
Pantoja, vexed.
Oh, how inopportunely.
The children are running to him. It appears they are telling him about it. Electra is going towards the grotto. Maximo is going after the girl. Electra flees from him. The Marquis and my nephew are talking heatedly.
Come. Be careful that Maximo does not interfere.
I am going.
Goes into the garden.
I fear some opposition. If I could...
Wishing to go, but not daring. Balbina, returning hurriedly from the garden.
Poor girl, calling for her mother. She has seated herself in the mouth of the grotto, surrounded by the children. And no one can move her from there.
And Maximo?
Filled with consternation like the rest of us. For we do not understand. I'm going to tell my mistress.
No, no. Have the Mother Superior and the sisters come?
They are here.
Do not say anything to your mistress. Go into the house and await my orders.
All right, sir.
Pantoja, undecided and as if frightened.
For the first time in my life I cannot seem to come to a decision. I shall go there.
At the entrance to the garden?
No. Shall I wait?
Making a resolve.
I am going.
A few steps away, Maximo stops him, coming very agitated and angry from the garden. Scene 10. Pantoja, Maximo. Maximo, speaking heatedly throughout the scene.
Stop. The Marquis tells me that after a long conversation with you, Electra went out from here in this terrible delirium.
Pantoja, disturbed.
Here, certainly. We were talking. The girl.
Bitten by the monster.
Perhaps. But the monster is not I. It is a terrible monster that feeds itself on human acts. It is called history.
Wishing to leave.
Farewell.
Maximo, seizing him firmly by the arm.
Stop. You are going to repeat now, right now, that which this monster of history told her to put her in such a state.
Pantoja, not knowing what to say.
First of all, it is necessary to establish first that...
I don't wish any preambles. The truth, concrete, precise, exact. You have offended Electra. You have upset her reason. With what words? With what ideas? I must know it quickly, quickly. It concerns a woman who is all the world to me.
To me she is more. She is both heaven and earth.
Let me know at once the machinery you have set in motion against this poor orphan, against me, against us both, united now forever by the fusion of our souls. Let me know what poison you have put into the ear of her whom I can and ought to call already my wife.
Pantoja makes signs of doubt.
What are you saying? That she will not be my wife? And you even jest.
I have said nothing.
Maximo, breaking out in a rage, attacks him with great violence.
Well, by that silence, by that jest, mask of an egotism so great that the world cannot hold it, by that virtue, true or false, I know not, which in the shadow and without noise hurls the dart that annihilates us.
Seizes him by the collar and hurls him on the bench.
And by that mildness that poisons, by that suavity that poisons, may God confound you, great man or humble, eagle, snake, whatever you may be.
Pantoja, recovering his breath.
What brutality! Infamous one! Madman!
I? Yes, I am. You drive us all mad.
Recovering from his rage.
Who but you has had the diabolical power to take away the strength of my character, driving me to this terrible anger? Without considering it, I have crushed a weak and mean being, incapable of replying to force with force.
Pantoja, sitting up.
I shall reply with force.
Returning to his normal state, expresses himself with a sententious calmness.
You are physical force, I am spiritual force.
Maximo looks at him astonished and confused.
I can do more than you, infinitely more. Do you doubt it?
What more can you do?
Wrath stifles you, pride blinds you. I, ill-treated and mocked, recover easily my serenity. You know, you tremble, Maximo. You who are force, you tremble.
I am still trembling with rage. Do not provoke it.
Pantoja, this time master of himself.
I shall neither provoke it nor do I fear it. Because you ill-treat me, I forgive you.
Forgive me. Me? Better insist that I should be a murderer, and you will succeed.
Pantoja, with serene and cold gravity, without boasting.
Get angry. Cry out. Strike. Here I am immovable. There is no human force that can move me, no power that can separate me from my course. Injure me, wound me, kill me, I shall not defend myself. Barbarism may destroy my poor body, which is worth nothing, but that which is here,
to his mind,
who can destroy it? And if, perchance, my will should be annihilated by death, the idea which I maintain will always remain alive, triumphant.
I do not see, I cannot see, great ideas in one who does not have greatness, in one who has no pity, tenderness, nor compassion.
My ends are very high. I go towards them, by any means possible.
Maximo, terrified.
By any means possible. Towards God there is but one way to go, the right way.
With exultation.
O God, thou canst not permit that one should reach thy kingdom through dark byways, nor that one should reach thy glory trampling on the hearts of those who love. No, God, thou wilt not permit that. No, no. Rather than see a thing so absurd, let us see all nature in ruin and all the machinery of the universe broken.
Sacrilege! You offend God with your words.
And you offend him more with your acts.
Enough. I shall not argue with you. I have nothing more to say to you.
Nothing more? You have said nothing.
Takes him vigorously by the arm.
Now go with me in search of Electra, and in her presence either clear up my doubts and relieve me of this terrible anxiety, or you perish, and I perish, and we all shall perish. I swear it by the memory of my mother.
Pantoja, after looking at him fixedly.
Let us go.
They take a few steps, and Evarista comes out of the house. Scene 11. The same, Evarista. After her, the Mother Superior, and two sisters of La Penitencia. Afterwards, Patros.
What has happened, Maximo? I heard your voice, angry.
This man. Come, come, aunt.
The Mother Superior and the sisters appear. He is alarmed at seeing them.
Oh, those women!
Patras enters hastily from the garden. Patras, suffering and weeping.
Mistress, the young lady has lost her reason. She is running about, fleeing, calling on her mother. She neither sees nor hears those who wish to calm her.
Evarista, advancing towards the garden.
My darling child!
Maximo, looking towards the garden.
Now she is coming.
Releases Pantoja and rushes out.
The master and the marquis have succeeded in quieting her, and are almost dragging her.
Electra appears, led by Don Urbano and the marquis, beside them Maximo. On seeing the persons on the stage, she makes some resistance. Gently and affectionately they force her to approach. She has her hair and her bosom decorated with flowers. Scene 12. Electra, Maximo, Evarista, Pantoja, Don Urbano, the Marquis, Patras, the Mother Superior, and the two sisters.
My daughter, what delirium is this?
Maximo, hastening to her affectionately.
My dear one, come, listen to me. My affection will be your reason.
Electra, getting away from Maximo with a movement of modesty. Her delirium is calmed, no cries nor bursts of laughter. She speaks with accents of resigned and melancholy grief.
Do not come near me. I am not yours. No, no.
Why do you flee from me? Where are you going without me?
Pandora, who has passed to the right, to Electra's side.
To truth, to eternal peace.
I am looking for my mother. Do you know where my mother is? I saw her in the midst of the children's game. She went afterwards towards the mimosa at the mouth of the grotto. She was looking at me and fleeing.
The song of the children is heard in the distance.
Do you see Maximo? He will be your husband.
Maximo, with eagerness.
Nobody opposes it. There is no reason nor force to prevent it, Electra, my darling.
Electra, imposing silence.
Now there is no question of wives nor husbands. Oh, how sad my heart is. Now there are only fathers and brothers, many brothers. How large is the world, and how lonesome it is, how empty! Over it pass black clouds, the illusions that were mine and now are no one's. There are the illusions of no one. What solitude! Everything is extinguished, everyone weeps, the world is ending, is ending.
With an outburst of fear,
I wish to flee, I wish to hide myself. I do not wish fathers, I do not wish brothers. I want to go with my mother. Where is your tomb? There, both of us together, my mother and I shall tell her my sorrows, and she shall tell me the truth, the truth.
Pantoja, aside to Evarista,
it is the opportunity, let us take advantage of it.
My daughter, we shall take you to peace, to rest.
That is not peace. Rest and reason are here. Electra is mine.
Evarista starts to take her away.
I claim her.
Maximo, farewell. I do not belong to you. I belong to my sorrow. My mother calls me to her side.
Anxiously, expressing an intense emotion.
I hear her voice.
Her voice?
Silence! She calls me. She calls me!
With joy and delirium.
Daughter, come to your senses.
Do you hear? I am coming, mother.
Runs after the two sisters.
Let us go.
To Maximo, who wishes to follow her.
I alone. She calls me alone. You, no. Me alone. Do you not hear the voice which says, Electra! I am coming to you, my dear mother.
The sisters, Evarista and Pantoja, surround her.
Iniquity! To rob me of her, they have deprived her of her reason.
He tries to release himself from the arms of the Marquis and Don Urbano.
Do not lose yours, too.
Restraining himself.
Calm.
Let us go now. We shall recover her.
Ah!
As if stifled.
Take me back to truth. Take me back to science. This uncertain, lying world is not for me.
End of Act 4. Act 5 of Electra by Benito Perez Galdós. Translated by Charles Alfred Jurel. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Act 5. Short Curtain. Locutory in San Jose de la Penitencia. Lateral doors. In the back, a window through which the patio is seen. Scene 1. Evarista, Sister Dorotea. Evarista, entering with a nun.
Don Salvador?
He came a while ago. He is in the office with the Mother Superior and the Sister Treasurer.
Urbano will find him there. While they are talking there, Sister Dorotea, tell me what the girl does, thinks, and says. The selection of yourself, so sweet and gentle to accompany her constantly and to be her friend and confidant in this solitude, has been very fortunate.
Electra honours me with her affection, and I do not contribute little, it is true, to calm her disturbed soul.
Evarista, pointing to her forehead.
And how is...
Very well, madam. Her reason has recovered its clearness, and she would be entirely over the derangement if she did not always have the fixed idea of wanting to see her mother, to talk with her, and to hope from her the solution of her doubts and her ignorance. All the time that she is free from her religious duties, and some time that she takes from them, she spends in the patio where we have our cemetery, and in the garden nearby. There, as in our room, the idea of her mother absorbs her whole mind.
Tell me something else. Does she remember Maximo? Does she still think of him?
Yes, madam, but in prayer and meditation her thought cultivates the idea of loving him as a brother, and in the end, as she told me today, she hopes to succeed.
Her thoughts! It is necessary that the heart should respond to this idea. Everything would result very well according to our plans if it were not for the unfortunate occurrence of the day before yesterday, which upsets things somewhat.
An unfortunate occurrence?
Our good friend, Don Leonardo Questo, the broker, died.
I did not know.
A great misfortune. A few days ago he did not feel very well. He foresaw his end. Monday he went out early, and in the street he lost consciousness. They took him to his house, and he died at 3 in the afternoon.
Poor man.
In his will, Leonardo makes Electra the heiress of the half of his fortune.
Ah.
But with the express condition that the child must abandon the religious life. Do you know whether Don Salvador is informed of these things?
I suppose, since he knows everything, and what he doesn't know he guesses.
That is so.
Dorothea, seeing Don Urbano coming.
Don Urbano.
Scene 2. The same Don Urbano.
Have you seen him?
Yes. I have left him working in his office, with a skill, with a fixedness of attention that would astonish you. Such a head.
Has he heard of Cuesta's last will?
Yes.
Evarista to Don Urbano.
Did you find our friend much vexed?
If he is, no one knows it. His strength of will is such that even in the most distressing conditions, he shows in his face the emotion of his great soul.
Evarista, interrupting him.
Indeed, he dominates over human weaknesses, and, like an eagle, rises higher and higher above where the storms break.
When I asked him concerning his hope of retaining Electra, he replied with more calmness than boasting, I trust in God.
What grandeur of soul! And did he know that the Marquis and Maximo are the executors?
He knew more. He received at noon a letter from them announcing that they would come this afternoon, accompanied by a notary, to ask the girl whether she would accept or refuse the inheritance.
And in the face of this communication?
Nothing. The man is so tranquil, repeating the formula which describes him at one stroke, I trust in God.
Scene 3. The same. Maximo, the Marquis at the left.
We shall wait here.
Maximo, seeing Evarista.
Ah, whom have we here? Aunt.
Salutes her with affection. Evarista, replying to the salute of the Marquis.
Marquis. So after all, there are hopes of winning the battle?
I don't know. We are struggling with a wild beast of much sagacity.
And you, Maximo, do you think?
That the monster knows much, and is a consummate master in these struggles. But I trust in God.
You? You?
Naturally, one who loves truth trusts in God. It is for truth that we are fighting. How can we believe that God will abandon us? It cannot be, aunt.
In passing through the patios, have you seen Electra?
No.
Dorothea at the window.
Come in now. She's coming from the cemetery.
Maximo going to the window with Don Urbano.
Ah, how sad, how beautiful. The whiteness of her habit makes her look like an apparition.
Calling to her.
Electra!
Silence!
I cannot contain myself.
Looks at her again.
But is she living? Is she in her beautiful reality, or is she an image worthy of the altar? Now she is coming back. She lifts her eyes to heaven. If I saw her vanish in the air like a shadow, I should not be surprised. She lowers her eyes. She stops. Of what is she thinking?
Continues looking at Electra. Marquis, who has remained in the proscenium with Evarista.
Yes, madam. False with entire falsehood.
Be careful what you are saying.
Either the venerable Don Salvador is mistaken, or he has told voluntarily the contrary of the truth, moved by reasons and aims to which our limited intelligence cannot reach.
Impossible, Marquis. A man so righteous, of such high ideals, failing in the truth.
And who can assure you, madam, that in the depths of these exalted consciousnesses there is not a moral law whose subtleties are far beyond us? There are absurdities in the life of the spirit as well as in nature, where we see a thousand phenomena whose causes are not what they seem to be.
It cannot be. No, no, no. There are cases in which lying smooths over the paths of goodness, but have we a case of this kind? No, no.
In order that you may form a judgment, listen to what I have to say. Virginia assures me that this man here is the child of Josefina Perret, and she knows it without any mystification or deception. And she proves it as the most clear and simple problem. Moreover, I am able to prove that Lazarus Yust was not in Madrid between the years 63 and 66.
Anyway, Marquis, I cannot get it into my head.
Marquis, seeing Pantoja appear at the right.
Here he is.
Maximo, returning to the front of the stage.
The beast is here.
With permission, I will retire.
Exit to the left. Pantoja remains a moment at the door. Scene 4. Evarista, Maximo, Don Urbano, the Marquis, Pantoja. Pantoja, advancing slowly.
Pardon me if I have kept you waiting.
Sir Pantoja, being informed of the object of our visit, it is not necessary to repeat it.
Marquis, kindly.
We do not repeat it in order not to mortify you, for you will now give the battle up as lost.
Pantoja, serenely, without boastfulness.
I never lose.
That is saying a great deal.
And I am certain that Electra knows now how to scorn worldly goods and will not accept the inheritance.
Maximo, restraining his wrath.
Oh?
So you see, this man does not surrender.
I do not surrender. Never. Never.
So I see.
Not able to contain himself.
He must be killed.
Let death come.
We shall not go as far as that.
Go as far as you like. You will always find me at my post, immovable.
We trust in the law.
I trust in God.
The law is God, or ought to be.
Ah, gentlemen of the law, I tell you that Electra, adapting herself easily to this life of purity, fond now of prayer and of sweet religious peace, does not desire at all to leave this house.
Maximo, impatiently.
Shall we be able to see her?
Not just now.
Maximo, wishing to protest angrily.
Oh!
Be calm.
I cannot.
It is the choir hour. Don Salvador means that after prayers...
Exactly. And in order that you may be convinced that I have no fear, you may bring not only the notary, but the congressional deputy, if you like. I shall have the doors of the building opened. I shall allow you to talk as long as you like with Electra, and if she wishes to leave, let her leave quickly.
You will do as you say?
Why not, since I trust in God?
Maximo and Pantoja look at each other in silence.
And I, too.
Well, if you trust, here I await you.
We shall return this afternoon.
Takes Maximo by the arm.
And we to the church.
Exeunt Don Urbano, Evarista, Pantoja. Scene 5. The Marquis, Maximo, who goes agitated about the stage, impatient and distrustful.
What do you say to this?
That this man of superior talent in charming the weak and jesting with the strong will drive us all mad. I am not built that way. In struggles of this kind, will against will, I feel myself drawn to violence.
What would you do then?
Take her away willingly or by force. If I haven't enough strength, look for it, acquire it, buy it. Bring friends, accomplices, a squadron, an army.
With increasing heat.
The romantic ages and the ferocities of feudalism are reborn within me.
And a man of science thinks and talks like that?
Extremes meet.
More excited.
This man, this monster, it is necessary to kill him.
Not quite, my son. Let us imitate him. Let us be as cunning, as insidious, as persevering.
Maximo, with eloquence.
Let us be as I am, sincere, brave, valiant. Let us meet the enemy with a bold face. Let us destroy him if we can, or let ourselves be destroyed by him. But all at once, in a single action, in a single onslaught, at one stroke. Either him or us.
No, my friend, no. We have to go with a steady hand. It is necessary for us to respect the social order in which we live.
And this social order in which we live will involve us in a network of lies and evasions, and in this net we shall perish drowned, with no defense. Our hands and our necks caught in the meshes of 1,001 legal caprices, of 1,001 false, corrupt intentions.
Be calm. Let us prepare for that which awaits us this afternoon. Let us anticipate the obstacles in order that we may plan how to conquer them. What will happen when we tell Electra that you and she are not brother and sister?
What do you suppose will happen? Why, she will not believe us, for in her mind the error has been fixed, and it will be impossible to destroy it. Don't you know what continual suggestion can do, what the atmosphere of this house can do with the ideas of those who live in it?
Let us use, then, efficient means.
Maximo, with greater violence.
Efficient, yes. Set fire to the house, set fire to Madrid.
No nonsense. In case the child does not wish to leave, we shall take her by force.
Maximo, excited to the end.
Either conquering force or conquering despair. I shall die, she will die, we shall all die.
Die? No. Let us live, wide awake. Let us prepare for the worst. I have the keys to get into the new street. Sister Dorothea is on our side. Hush.
On to violence.
Astuteness, cunning.
By the straight road.
By the indirect road.
Taking his arm.
And let us go, for our presence here may arouse suspicions.
Taking him away.
Let us go, yes.
Trust in me.
I trust in God.
Change of scene. Patio in San Jose de la Penitencia. At the right, the side of a church, with windows through which the light comes. At the left, a door leading to another patio, which communicates with a street. In the background, between the church and the buildings on the left, a great arch, through which one can see the border of the cemetery of the congregation. Dark night. Scene 6. Electra Dorothea.
As certain as that it is night, two gentlemen have come to the house with the proposition to take you out into the world. Don't you believe it?
Two gentlemen. Before you tell me their names, my heart guesses them. Maximo and the Marquis of Ronda. If it is true that they wish to take me with them, they disturb me very much. When I came into this holy house, I began, as you know, the great battle with my spirit. I have tried, with the help of God, to change into brotherly love, the love of a very different kind that fills my heart. That fire of the sun having been kindled in my heart with such violence, it is not an easy task to change it into the cool light of the moon. But in the end, by continual meditation, the dismay of my heart, and the sweet ideas that God has sent me, have given me strength to conquer in the battle.
My sister, if you feel in you the strength of the new love, why do you fear to see Maximo?
Because seeing him, I think that all the ground gained will be lost in a single moment.
Dorothea, incredulously.
And are you sure that you have gained this ground?
Oh, yes, some. Not much yet.
I understand, my dear sister, that seeing the person will help you to prove it, if indeed you can.
Electra, with vivacity.
Oh, don't say it! As I am today, in the beginning of this struggle, my conscience would not have a moment's peace by his side. Oh, my God, I am struggling with two impossibilities. I cannot love him as a brother, and I cannot love him as a husband.
Terrified.
What torture in the world! No! I prefer to be here in this solitude of death, in this laboratory of my soul, and by this divine crucible in which I am fusing a new being.
Do not hope, Electra, that your own ideas will give you peace. Trust in God and in those whom God sends you.
With resolution.
My sister, do not tremble before him whom you believe your brother. Someone, perhaps, will deny that he is.
Electra, very excited.
Be still, be still. In an affair so delicate, every word that does not bring me certainty is a cruel word which does not calm me, but drives me crazy. My God, give me the truth or give me death.
Calm yourself.
Electra, more excited.
All the confusion I had when I came here is coming back again. Angels and demons are struggling in my thoughts. Leave me. I wish to flee from myself.
Goes up and down on the stage in great agitation. Sister Dorothea goes after her and tries to calm her.
Calm yourself. Do. My dear sister, your torments are near the end.
Looks anxiously towards the door on the left. Electra, thinking she hears voices in the distance.
Listen. My mother calls me.
Do not become delirious. Other voices, voices of living persons, will call you.
It is my mother. Silence.
Listening. Enter Pantoja at the left. Scene 7. Electra, Pantoja, Dorothea.
My daughter, how did you get out of the church without my seeing you?
We went out to get some fresh air. Electra was stifling.
Aside.
The hour approaches. God will help us.
My daughter, do you not feel well?
Electra, in a fearful voice.
My mother is calling me.
Pantoja, taking her hand affectionately.
The sweet voice of your mother, speaking to you in the spirit, will comfort you, will bind you with bonds of piety and love to this holy house.
The choir of novices is heard in the church.
Listen, my daughter. These voices of the angels which are calling to you from heaven.
Electra, delirious.
It is the song of the choir. Between these tender voices there rises that of my mother, calling me to her tomb.
It is an hallucination. It is the voice of the heavenly angels.
There are no angels. No, no. I hear my name. I hear the voices of the choir which stirs my whole soul. They are the sons of men who rejoice in life.
She continues to hear the voices of the choir. Pantoja, uneasily.
Sister Dorothea, tell the sister custodian that she should watch the door of the new street and that of Ronda Street.
I will, sir.
No, I will go. I trust no one. I wish to watch the doors, all the patios and corners of the building.
Alarmed, thinking he hears a noise.
Silence. Don't you hear?
What? Nothing, sir. It is fear.
Thought I heard the sound of voices. Knocks at some door down below.
Listens.
In what direction?
Looking towards the rear behind the church.
In the direction of the infirmary. Oh, I have no peace. I wish to see for myself. Electra, go back to the church. Sister, you take her. They are waiting for me there.
Hurrying them.
Quick.
Takes them to the door of the church. Goes quickly and uneasily. Dorothea sees him leave, takes Electra's hand, and returns with her to the center of the stage. Electra, as if powerless, lets herself be led. Scene 8. Electra, Dorothea.
They are coming. Not to the church, though.
Here. I want to get my breath. I want to live.
Dorothea, aside, uneasy.
This is the hour set for the marquis. Let us take advantage of the minutes, of the seconds, or all will be lost.
Looking to the left.
I am going to open their way to this patio.
Aloud.
Sister, wait for me here.
Electra, frightened.
Where are you going?
Seizes her hand. Dorothea, decisively.
To look out for you, to return to you your health and life, to arrange for you to leave this tomb and to take me with you.
Electra, trembling.
Sister, do not leave me.
This moment will decide your fate. You will return to the world. You will see Maximo.
When?
Now. You will see him enter here.
Pointing to the left.
Silence. Courage. Do not stop me. Do not move from here.
Goes quickly out at the left.
Oh, my God, Holy Virgin, is it true that... Here! He is coming here!
Thinks she sees Maximo in the darkness.
Ah, it is he, Maximo.
Speaking as in a dream, she moves away from what she thinks is a real being.
Away from me. Leave me. I cannot love you as a brother. I cannot... In the fire is the crucible in which I wished to fuse a new heart. Don't you see that I cannot look at you? Why are you looking at me? Do not take me out into the world. Here I am seeking truth. My mother is calling me.
With accents of despair.
Mother! Mother!
Turns her face to the rear. As the last words of Electra are spoken, there appears the shade of Eleutheria, a beautiful figure dressed as a nun. Electra, her back to the audience, with her arms crossed, looks at her.
Oh!
A long pause. Scene 9. Electra, the shade of Eleutheria, which is seen vaguely in the darkness in the background. Electra advances towards it. The figures remain facing each other as near as possible.
I am your mother, and I come to calm the anxieties of your loving heart. My voice will give back peace to your conscience. No bond of nature unites you to the man you have chosen for a husband. That which you heard was an invention dictated by affection, to bring you into our company and to the peace of this holy house.
Oh, mother, what consolation you give me!
I am telling you the truth, and I give it strength and hope. Accept, my daughter, as a test of the temple of your heart, this transitory seclusion, and do not bear ill will to those who brought you here. If marital love and the pleasures of the family call your soul, allow yourself to leave this sweet attraction, and do not pretend to a holiness you cannot attain. God is in all parts. I do not know how to find him outside of here. Seek him in the world along paths better than were mine, and...
The shade is silent and disappears as the voice of Maximo is heard. Last scene. Electra, Maximo, the Marquis, Dorothea, Pantoja. Maximo in the door.
Electra!
Electra running towards him.
Ah!
Pantoja at the right.
My daughter, where are you?
Here, with us.
She is ours.
Are you running away from me?
No, she is not running away. She has come to life.
End of Act 5. End of Electra by Benito Perez Galdós, translated by Charles Alfred Urell.